School of Data Science, the best school for postgraduate program in data science, business analytics, and big data, in association with IBM. Industry association with IBM, AWS Educate, NVIDIA DLI, UBTech. IBM has set up Business Analytics Lab. Final certification is issued by IBM. Aegis facilitates scholarships, financial aid, and study loans available. We will work on live projects from the industry. Curriculum designed with the help of top data scientists and companies. Hands-on exposure to machine learning, stats, deep learning, NLP, Google TensorFlow, Spark, IBM Watson, AWS ML, and many more. Highly satisfied students with amazing reviews. Program delivered by IBM experts and the best data scientists. Program follows globally acceptable North American credit structure. Proud alumni working as data scientists with leading organizations. Participants can get opportunities for internships and final job placement with leading organizations. Aegis organizes Aegis Graham Bell Awards, Aegis' largest data science congress deep learning summit, meetups, and leadership speaker series. Network with the best data scientists and AI experts from around the world. Present your projects to the world. World-class delivery infrastructure and cloud learning management system. Three delivery models, full-time, executive weekend classroom, and online live interactive. Add wings to your career and explore today at www.aegis.edu.in.
And NVIDIA are joining hands today. How do we bring skills to India for data science? And more importantly, how people understand how to apply deep learning, which is a critical foundation, how India is going to transform itself, and it's really important.
Hello, I am Sharvari Chavan. I am a student from PGP September 2018 batch of data science, big data and business analytics, and I came here to update my knowledge in the data science. Previously I was working with Capgemini. I had 3.5 years of experience in web development and in database management. So I wanted to learn something new in data world, and hence I joined Aegis. And Aegis has not only helped me with updating my knowledge, but also prepared me for the new journey in business is in business analytics domain, and with the help with the all the efforts of all the professors and my efforts, I got placed in Unifor, and I'm very excited for my new journey in the new field. And I would recommend everybody to learn data science. It is very good.
This is Namit. So I started my journey at Aegis School of Business 9 months ago. I come from a bio background, and I joined this course because in today's industry, data helps us drive business decisions. And organizations are looking forward to data scientists and data engineers who can use this data and give them solutions that traditional business decisions can't. So after coming to Aegis, we got introduced to a multitude of courses, including Python, R language, machine learning, you name it. And we also had regular
side, you know, for this meetup. It was really encouraging to see, it's not the number that counts, but to be available here on Sunday afternoon, that too also post lunch. So you are welcome. I don't know what is your expectation from this. I will set the expectation. Before that, let me introduce myself. I'm Gangopadhyay. You can call me Obijit, and I am associated with the institute, basically a teacher, and so I'd like you all to introduce yourself so that we can start. I think I'll take the privilege of introducing my Mr. Bhupesh, who is the CEO of this organization. Actually, he conceptualized everything so that we can start a unique program of data science in Mumbai, and we are now working in two campuses more. One is in Pune and another one is Bangalore. So this is all about us. So if you can just tell, you just tell your name and where from you are representing, so that we can really anchor. And what you expect also.
Hi, my name is Shankar. I am working in Vodafone Idea. My expectation is to understand different domains, how the all these ML and data science technology be used.
By education you are?
Sorry?
By your education training, what you are? You are actually an IT engineer or something, what?
No, I have a, I'm working already as a data scientist in Vodafone Idea.
Okay. Yeah. And is your graduation or something, what? What is your background, academic background?
B-tech.
Okay. Thank you. If you can just tell so that we can put our...
Hello, my name is Gurdit Singh. I have completed my graduation this year. I've completed BSc Computer Science. And my interest in data science, what I expect is that I believe data has been used everywhere, and every year it's been increasing in terms of the amount it's been produced and how it has been used in business. I'm fascinated by it, and I want to pursue data science.
Great, welcome.
My name is Pratik Khanna. I have completed my graduation in BSc Computer Science. So my expectation is to know the faculty of Aegis, and I want to become a data scientist because I like the concept of data science, as how you can use data and what do you say?
You are working anywhere? No. It's okay.
Pleasure.
Welcome. Thank you.
Good evening. I am Manish Sondhi, and I have master's in telecom and a management degree in telecom. I am working with Reliance Jio, and I have come here to understand the various use cases and how I can implement at my end.
Excellent. What's your name?
Manish Sondhi.
Manish. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Aditya. I'm from a software engineering background from data warehousing and business intelligence, and I want to know more about data science in general.
Hello guys, good afternoon. My name is Deep Shah. I recently graduated from NM College, and I'm also already pursuing actuarial science, and I've cleared 4 papers in it. Now I wish to explore the field of data science. Already I'm exploring a lot of areas like the share markets. I also want to explore data science and want to gain knowledge about how this works and the different areas about data science, like artificial intelligence, machine learning, obviously, and wish to explore about different business opportunities as well as job opportunities in India, because I think India is too backwards in, you know, in this. It's not so much, it's not a recognized field right now in India. So I just wish gain more knowledge about the field of data science over here.
Thank you. I can give it to her.
Hi. My name is Aisha Khan. I did my master in statistics this year, and then I joined Larsen & Toubro, and I'm working over there. And I want to know more about the use cases, the practical applications. Till now, I was more into theoretical concepts, so my expectations are to learn more about the use cases over here.
Excellent. Thank you.
Hello and good afternoon, everybody. Myself, Indranil Banerjee. I work for Tata Consultancy Services. I came from an HCM background, HR, so moved to digital HR. So there's a lot happening around big data analytics. Just came to know the point of view of use cases and to understand something more about data. Thank you.
Okay, we are able to hear you. Tell us.
No, sir.
Okay. So, it's with you. Okay.
Hello, good afternoon to everyone. Myself, H. Mahesh, and I am IT professional. So, I want to understand these all catchwords, AI, data science, analytics, how they are interrelated, and what are the use cases I can use in my profession. So, that's the thing, that's my expectation from myself.
Okay, thank you. Manish, you will not introduce.
Yeah, hi, my name is Madhav Jha and I have completed my BTech in computer science. Currently, I'm working with Morgan Stanley as an ETL developer, and the main reason for me, like the expectation from this seminar, is to understand how we should proceed in the field of data science and analytics. Because like there are n number of options available in the market, but the whole purpose that I'm here for is to understand how we should proceed with it. So. That's the understanding.
Sandeshman, you will not tell. Okay, thank you. And there are our colleagues here, actually.
Yeah.
It's better
good
that
afternoon.
At least you introduce.
My name is Barkat Mirza, and I'm working in Informa Tech. I reside in Bandra. So, the main thing, like, I've come here is, like, I'm more into artificial intelligence. So, I've heard, like, data science is the basic of AI and ML and deep learning. So that's why I've come here. So I want to understand what is the data science and
you came from Bangalore?
No, Bandra.
Bandra.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hey, hi. This is myself Anil. I'm BCom graduate. Completed my master's in information management. Currently, I'm working with the Visa Digital Services as an IT manager.
Excellent. Welcome. So, Manish. एक बार बोल दो ना वेल से सिंस यू आर हियर
आफ्टरनून दिस इज मनीष एंड आई एम अ पार्ट ऑफ द एडमिशन एंड मार्केटिंग टीम एट एजिस एंड आई एम वर्किंग इन एजिस फ्रॉम लास्ट 4 इयर्स थैंक यू
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन एंड वेलकम माय नेम इज संदेश आई एम आल्सो पार्ट ऑफ द एडमिशंस टीम विद एजिस
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन माय नेम इज निमित एंड आई एम पार्ट ऑफ मार्केटिंग टीम फॉर एजिस
थैंक यू आई थिंक नाउ आई डोंट नो we could anchor ourselves. What is your expectation? It is as varied as you could see, and that is what exactly is the data science applications are. So it is not drawn from one singular faculty, and the experience and other things will be varying. It's a very dynamic thing which is happening across the academic world. Now nothing is static, so you have to keep on learning new things because. The idea is that more technological advances will take place, and that is why we are trying to meet up. Let me add few things about us. We are primarily an academic institution. We dream to become a research-based academic institution. And as a result, we would love to do lots of projects we are doing also. I think some of the projects and other things, which is in applications in terms of the data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence. Secondly, let me also tell you and assure you that I am not an expert in any of these things. So you need not. Actually, we believe in a collegial model of working. You have something which you know, and I have something to share with you. So you feel free to interact with us in any way. The structure is that I'll make a little bit of introductions as I understand from my anecdotal, historical perspective, because I have seen the changes which you must not have seen. I'm now living in a country, in a place, in a time series where things have changed which is beyond my comprehensions. And this is what exactly is making me alarm. It's good that some of you are yet to start your career, some of you in your mid-career, some of you are quite working in practices. But one thing is very common, all of you are feeling, including me, and that's why you are organizing this Meetup, that something needs to be learned. And that is the basic vision on which we are operating in this institute. We feel that again and again things will be learning. We operate on a very beautiful, clear understanding that the curriculum can't be static. It has to be dynamic. Say, for example, what you have taught in first year of our courses, we are slowly updating because we are doing research. Actually, we are applying it. Our dream is to apply all these things and make it so that those who are participants or students can get the maximum benefit. I really feel it's a very exciting thing. I was, I think from an anecdotal perspective, I can tell you that it was a really exciting thing. So I'll start with little bit of premises. It will be taken over by Mr. Bhupesh with some of the use cases, and I'll also try to discuss with some of the cases. So here we go. So this is, I think it's a very exciting field. So this data, people say, and I think is you have heard, must have heard lots about industrial entrepreneurs, they are telling data is the new oil. And AI is the new engine. And merging together is becoming integration. Come, welcome. Please come. You can come here now. There is no problem. There is no sequence here. So you can come anytime. So artificial intelligence, ML, machine learning, data science, if you look at it, they are very interconnected, very well knit. See, all of us today, we are discussing about data. Data is huge. I don't know how much data was there. When I did my PhD, in one of the IITs, I could not even understand how to process data. We used to work on mainframe. I think I'm sure many of you have not seen that. If you have seen, then you will understand. And then we used to use the holodids in terms of entering data. It was all full of mistakes, actually. It was not machine driven, it was human driven. We used to punch the card. Have you seen holodid cards? You have not seen. So data used to be binary, and it used to be entered in the computer system through that holodids. None of you have seen, so I am absolutely obsolete, so I have no right to talk to you now. Okay, that is how the mainframe used to work. Then a stage came when the data has to be, I am also a student of statistics. I studied in statistics in one of the, we are very proud of that statistics subjects. I don't know where she has studied. I studied from Indian Statistical Institute. So the name itself used to evoke lots of inquisitiveness. Not our time nobody used to study statistics, because there are more exciting fields. And it was in Calcutta, we started understanding the statistical sense. Then my professor used to say, the statistical sense is a data sense. Good that it is now becoming multidisciplinary in terms of its approach for treating data. And enormous data has to be tapped. And what exactly is happening in terms of data science is that earlier, most of the unstructured data were not tapped. Now time has come when you have to tap unstructured data, and this is essentially data science is working on making sense of in business, so that any business decision which is taken, optimizing it. So earlier decision was gut. I used to think from intuition. You know, there is all, if you are aware of decision making theories, one is an intuition, intuitive theories. Other one is your implicit favorites. You know, I like him because I like his face. So it's my favorites, you know, it's biases. And data used to be interpreted in that terms. And all data, we are incapable of analyzing unstructured data. Now, we have the mechanism, and that is what exactly the addition, as I understand, in terms of making data is a new oil. Because huge potentials are available. So for example, I need not ask you, but I think when I talk to you, I can understand through my understanding that how you are feeling in terms of that unstructured data can be capitalized. It has to be quantified. Earlier it was that is not, that thing was not there. Although tools were there. Statistical tools for analyzing data, mathematical tools. I don't differentiate between statistics and mathematics. Actually, but the data used to be processed, and unprocessed data has no meaning. And that was actually happening, huge number of unprocessed data. Now, it's a mind-boggling thing, how much you can predict now. Exactly what you do, you collect data, analyze it, and for the effective prediction, so that ultimately it is integrated with your decision process. So decision errors are minimized. That is what is the field of data science, okay? And that is what I think, this is a very interesting thing. We'll be talking on data management. When you talk about use cases, you are reimagining business scenario. So for example, today, if you think about any business decision, why you make mistakes? And subsequently we repent. I take the case whom I respect most because I have worked in the Tata Institute for many years, Mr. Ratan Tata, JRD Tata, and all of them, especially Ratan Tata, has a dream to provide car to everybody. But now he's a very pensive man. His Nano could not take off. Why? He projected it as a poor man's car. It's a news case. Huh? Why? Because nobody wants to be poor. That is basic lack of understanding of people. So nobody wants to be branded as poor. Say a thing has come to this stage, it is better to go by a bicycle, a scooter, than go by a Nano, a poor man's car. You are branded at it. As a result, it has failed. So it's inadequate way, because he has done it in a traditional way. It's a gut feeling. People needs a vehicle. People needs a safer vehicle. I don't know what is the reason. The person who can drive in two-wheeler, and it's Emmanuel death. How many deaths have taken place last 2 days in Bombay, in the potholes where the two-wheelers have fallen? Enormous. And so many people have got injured. Even my also has got injured once. I could not see a pothole, and then I fell down. And 20 days I could not breathe, actually. It has hurt me here. The idea is, but still I would not prefer to go by Nano. It's a managerial decision error. Am I able to make it? And data science wants to eliminate that. No decision could be taken on gut. And that is what exactly is the objective. And this is emerging AI. I don't know. We'll try to, all of you have some idea. I have also some idea about AI. What is AI? How much AI is there? In my student days, my professor used to tell us that AI is essentially fuzzy logic. But now we have understood AI is not fuzzy logic. It is beyond that. Fuzzy logic is essentially, and what we got real satisfaction using in home domestic appliances, the fuzzy logic. It's basically, but that is also a form of AI, inferior form. Okay. Now if you look at this, getting the basic concept of machine learning, what exactly it is happening? Things are becoming more complicated. In terms of the machine learning, we are now concerned with that most of the things we are utilizing is that machine we have made them learn. How we can make a machine learn? What is learning? if I go back to the basic concept, learning is modifying the behavior. Now we have made machine to learn and tell us that, but and that means it is leading for a solid base of algorithm, a statistical and mathematical propositions in machine to behave in a particular way. All of us are learned by that way only. You see, I have been told by my, they have given me the tea also. Okay, everybody in the early days, all of you have learned this is a glass and that is a cup. A number of times, you know, you have been associated with that. That is how the machine learned. Okay, now if I say this is a cup, you will not agree. What is happening when, I still remember those days when my daughter was being taught about color. All of you have been taught that way. The moment you show her a color, she says it is green. And my wife will actually thrash her. It's not green, it's red. Okay, and after sometimes, you know, we all learn this way. Some algorithm, built-in algorithm is created in you. And that is what is machine learning. And if you can do that machine to learn, the problem is that today we are living in a world in which most of the difficult things are done by the machines only, not by anybody. Because human being cannot do that, because we have trained machine to detect. Say for example, you go for an online transactions, what do you happen? Immediately you get a notice. How come you are in North America, transactions being held from India? Are you the same person? Okay, that means my accounts and everything in bank, and bank asks me questions, are you the same person? That means machine is detecting that thing, and everyone, ATA, all our OTP and other things are machine generated, it's not human being generated, okay? You permit me because they have given me tea, so I should take it, but it's already cold. Okay. Now, impact of data science is on larger society. Please understand, I think data science is encompassing. And all challenges of future, we are going to do, and some use cases for developing appreciation for data science. It can be applied. I'll just give you pictorially, the science of engineering, making intelligent machines, especially intelligent computer programs. If you look at it, artificial intelligence is called as engineering and making intelligent machines and programs. If I talk about machine learning, ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. But you do it, and it's embedded one. And deep learning is a learning based on deep neural network. Say for example, today, how we learn as a human being, it's through our neural systems. All of you must be aware, if you know the composition of neural systems, all our nerves have a gap. They are called synaptic gaps. So, stimulus and response is essentially associated with that. Whenever some stimulus comes, you see, if it is a rigid, if you ask me, raise your hand. Now, I have learned when you say raise your hand, these are all we are learning. But if it had been straight, I would not have, it was a rigid one, but it's a very flexible. That is what is exactly will be happening. And it's a spectrum. You can see 1950, 1970s onwards, we are now coming in the age of deep learning. So this is also a part of the data science exposures. What is the difference between artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning? If you look at it, any techniques which enables computers to mimic human behavior is artificial intelligence. I think the simplest definition which I can think of. Okay, you can mimic it, you can just copy it. Then machine learning is essentially the techniques that give you the computer ability to learn without being explicitly, it's an embedded program. And deep learning is a subset of machine learning. So we are primarily meeting here today to get a little bit of understanding about it, not a deeper one, because all these subjects can be a postgraduate program. And it's very integrated. But basics are, of all these subjects are, primarily your ability of cognitive thinking. All these things are actually imbibing in true technology on machines so that you can start thinking and taking decision appropriately based on your data. So, major data was not being utilized. Now, changes in macro and micro data will revolutionize the way you manage business. Now, today you cannot, it has to be dynamic. Because what is happening today, no business decision is possible. Do you think that present state of affairs in our country is being, cannot be predicted? It was well predicted by all theoreticians in terms of what is happening all over the world. So don't think that all of a sudden crude prices goes down without any connection. There is a lot of connectivity. Speculations has a rhythm in it. And that is what exactly is data science is predicting. So all of a sudden you can see the crude oil price is going down. Dollar price is going up. Gold prices are going down, going up. It's not a very erratic. You see bullion market, oil market, everything is essentially, and then you can manage the business. Today, most of the oil companies, the way they hedge, they use and analyze the data, and therefore they are the winner. Anybody who does not have competency, why everybody has a data science in a department in this one? Because they can get more definite predictions, and accordingly they can recommend. Then that is what exactly is the data science. Data offers unprecedented opportunity for decision makers. And I think decision makers cannot operate now anymore with gut feeling. So for example, we have seen, if you look at the use cases in case of Government of India, which I am fully part of it, our Niti Aayog has already stated that career bureaucrats to be substituted by professionals from industry. And they are parallelly being integrated. It's called lateral entry into our administrative services. Now the problem is that, and when they are inducted, actually they will bring some fresh air in terms of the way the bureaucracy functions in our country. And this is a decision of Niti Aayog. But the problem is that, you know, what happened in our bureaucratic system? Decisions were so stagnating, nothing was happening. Now the present government thinks, right or wrong, how they have come to these conclusions, let us not question that, but they have included. But the problem is that people are apprehensive because they don't have any data. The way you look, one of the person who have been selected for this, who works in UNESCO FAO, she's a lady. She has been selected. She once agreed to join, but subsequently she have decided not to join. Why? Because she could not predict whether she will be able to be effective in Indian government system. So therefore there is a gap. You know, unless you are very definite, you cannot decide on what you are going to do. So the way you are projecting, that's called sentiment analysis. So you have lost him or lost her. You'll be surprised to know, because I'm referring it to you, but please, if you are reading between the stories, now that lady who has not joined, her name is Kakuligo, she is in Italy now, she is in Rome. Now she has refused to join Government of India at a level of Joint Secretary, which is a dream for many. I think many dreamers are there in our country. Even the person who could not pass SSC, they want to become an IAS officer and become the secretary, joint secretaries, additional secretaries. But she has refused. Why? Because the sentiments of thinking about a bureaucracy, actually, deters somebody to take a decision. Many of you working in private sector have a different way of looking at the government sectors. Why it has happened? Because you have an inadequate data. Actually, it is no sector is supreme. All are uniform. But you have to understand that if you want to make a change. I don't know whether it will be possible. So implication of data is thinking like a data scientist is a process. And that is what exactly the objective of this one. Identify business initiatives. It can't be erratic. You can't take a business decision erratically. You have seen Indian Railway has introduced dynamic pricing for the railway tickets. It failed miserably. Why it failed? Because they could not get enough data how the people will react. Say, for example, if you decrease the price of any product and increase the price of a product, I'll give you some cases because I don't know. Hey, Monish, kitna time tak tumhe how much time? Another? Another half hour. Okay. because it's better that I think I should get the data, how much they want me, otherwise they may drive me out also. Then you have to understand, say for example, if you look at the implication of data, how you identify the shareholders, how you identify the analytical entities. You see, basically, it's basically analytical science, you know, data science or artificial intelligence, identify priorities in decisions. Then brainstorm the variables and matrices, and metrics, and then group scores, identify recommendations, map the scores on recommendations. Ultimately, data science lead for a better recommendations and suggestions. So for example, your cell phone is identified that you are in Horyanandani Hospital at Pawai. I don't know how much the data has been used. Use cases, examples will be Hiranandini Hospital should immediately identify and say if they should send you an SMS that if you need an executive health checkup or a preventive health checkup, you should visit the hospital. Okay. Now, these KFC outlets should tell you it's a time for you for lunch. Before they located you, they should have given you recommendations. If you come to KFC and if you show the SMS, you will be given 10% discounts. This is an optimization. So it may motivate you to go. Say for example, and if you look at this one, this is the interpretation of data which can be done. I think it has the business use cases because some of you really expected and it really impressed me by telling we would like to know how business could be impacted out of it. So cases like this will be possible only when you integrate data. What exactly should have been done? They should have analyzed what Indian lower middle class people wants. Do they like to be branded as poor or they would like to be branded as rich? If you brand anything for the poor, the person will not come. So imagine if you do this type of mistakes, your business gets affected and then you are at pain. Mr. Tata candidly accepted, and that is the greatness of him, that he said that I made a managerial decision error by branding the car, which has no problem. It can take you anywhere, I think, especially at a rate. It's much safer. It is not very unsafe also. So this is what is the interpretation of data. Now we are let's talk a little bit of artificial intelligence. You see, intelligence, I don't know how you look at it. Intelligence is a basically statistical concept actually. It's a cognitive ability. Now what is intelligence? Can anybody tell me what you mean by intelligence? Then we'll talk about artificial intelligence. What is intelligence? No, there's one of the it's a component of intelligence. But to be honest with you, intelligence can't be defined. And there is a statistician called Alfred Binet who developed the concept of IQ. All of you are telling, it's IQ comma. Everybody says in common language. This Binet, he's an Italian. He actually conceptualized the concept of intelligence. And then finally he wrote a treatise of book in which he concluded, last sentence of that one was, intelligence can be defined. It is what intelligent person does. And all of you are agreeing with that. What is intelligent, therefore? How the intelligent person behaves. And therefore, basically look at it. When you talk about artificial intelligence, you are thinking of simulating this type of thing. Say, one of the basic definition of intelligence would be that to do things smartly, to think effectively, every time you do or repeat an activity, next time you improve. That is what is intelligence. And therefore, it's connected with your cognition. That means it has an epistemological or cognitive biases. And these biases actually lead you to have a better effective. Now, can we pass this intelligence to everything? That means we have a technological enableness now. We have a multi-layer analytical tools like Hadoop, Python, which can be built in, and then we can really make technology machine applicable to technology. See, I don't know what about Texela and other things. People say it will be safe in Indian roads also, the cars which are driven by artificial intelligence. But I have seen many instances. in which, say for example, the 2 days back I was trying to book in Airbnb some accommodation in some country. After this, immediately I got a pop-up. He said that if you are doing this booking in this rental property, please note that this is not an app, they are not approved to rent out them because you will be having a difficulty in having an access to this property. Don't book it. It's a pop-up. That means they have analyzed the data. Are you able to get this, understand the problem? That means you should not book. The moment you book, you will be in trouble. Now we are, what exactly has happened? They have found that there is some sort of inconsistency in your data set. These properties, they have already blocked it, but still the owner wants to rent it out because they are in desperate condition, you know. And as a result, I think this type of things are happening. And this is not done by human being. It is done by automated, close to approximation of an intelligent behavior of a machine. And that is what is artificial intelligence in brief terms. Yeah, in the context, artificial intelligence is ability of a computer to exhibit intelligence. Is it not? That it can give you, basically it's a pattern. And if there is a deviation from a pattern, it can be detected. And that is what is essentially the term intelligence. I have already said it includes one capacity for logic, understanding. And intelligence is generally attributed to humans, but now we are trying to give it in the format of artificial intelligence to machines also. But it's possible, huh? Say for example, today, many of the decisions, people, experts prefer to give it to machine. Say, you know, I think, let us understand the implication of it. Suppose every surgical intervention by doctors are subject to lots of error. Now today, if you are having artificially driven robots to conduct the surgery, it minimizes the error. You can see every day thousands of flights lands in Mumbai Airport. Now, what is actually happening? It's done. It is landed by artificial intelligence driven automatic landing system. And this is what exactly, it corrects many things. But then you ask me why people have to be there? Because there can be error. That's why when you are doing the robotic surgery also, doctors are always in the panel to find out, to see how it is being done. If there's one mistake, it will be fatal. So essentially, intelligence, artificial intelligence. Therefore, your personal computer is also quite intelligent now. I think it can understand. Say for example, today our computer can understand, recognize what I want to do. It starts dictating. Nah? There's a consequence, you can see. And that is what is the major applications of artificial intelligence. Algorithm is the key to the intelligence. So it is true for human intelligence, it is true for artificial intelligence. If you have the algorithm, execution of algorithm plays an important role in exhibiting intelligence. However, compared with human program intelligence, in a machine, artificial intelligence is able to create its own algorithm through the process of machine learning. So one of the part of the data science will be understanding the machine learning. For that, you need to understand the basic mathematical concepts, application of statistical tools. Therefore, we are augmenting ability of all of us in terms of doing this. If you are averse to that, you cannot appreciate that. The all AI automated decision making figures out the best answer or the decisions with highest probability of success. Error will be there. Huh? Don't think that there won't be any error. And that's why you need always human monitoring for any given situation where the context of its expertise making better decision and key to the success. The buzzword of today's artificial intelligence, machine learning and deep learning, the concept and methodologies behind artificial intelligence are not at all new. It was a very, very age-old concept. By definition, artificial intelligence means something that is stimulated, not organic and typically created by human. What is more of intelligence, intelligence is somewhat subjective. Artificial intelligence will be more of objective. That is, it will create. By definition, artificial intelligence is something that is stimulated, not organic and typically created by human. The exponential technology advancement is an example of human advancement. Because all the technologies, exponential technology, which are disruptive in nature, are considered to be this. I'll avoid this. Artificial intelligence trends are, will go to the future is expert believe that almost third of the global workforce will be automated by 2030. And this is McKinsey's assumptions. But the university is preparing students for the rise of office machines. Are you getting yourself? And that is what exactly is happening. I'm a teacher for about 50 years now, 48 years. I meet my students, those who are very senior. They come and say, sir, what I should do now? Because they have not taken the tune with the reality. So in this institute, I have experienced people with all age, all shades of people, academics, qualifications, are joining to get themselves reoriented. The thing is that it's basically the future is that. And as a lot of people assumes automation is the only going to affect blue-collar job. Don't worry, it will affect everyone. So long as your university will be immune to that. This is Martin Ford's author of The Rise of Robots, Technology, treats the jobless of the future, but no one is true will be much broader, will avoid the broader impact. The challenges are many. Reports by McKinsey, as you have said, that 18 million careers, 30% of the global job force, from doctors to accountant, it has cut across all the boundaries, you know. So for example, today, with the IBM medical application of Watson, I think you don't need anything. So for example, I can feed all the parameters of mine and machine can predict how long I will be able to survive. Only thing is that, but it has to be monitored by human being, but this is going to happen. And lawyers, I think basically you know, you are talking about use cases. In the case of judiciary, most of the judges, they don't know how to write judgment. And that's why there's a law, so much of pending. They take the advice of legal experts to write a judgment. Otherwise, it is again questions and cost. Now the question is that there should be enough opportunity given to the criminal justice system. Because if you really make more number of judges, don't think that it will expedite the process of criminal administration. It's just justice administration. Machines are taking cognitive capability beginning to compete our ability to reason. And this is what is happening. Say, for example, today, in case of data, say hacking, the most of the hacking are taking place by machines, not by human being, because it's so complicated. Therefore, at some point of time, human beings are going to be subjugated to that. Impact of artificial intelligence on society will be, the transportation industry looks like it will be first completely disrupted by artificial intelligence. We are all beneficiaries. Have you seen how much our Kala Pila taxi went out of circulation? And we are all in beneficiaries of this artificial, you see, Ola, Uber, and classic examples how it can happen. Next industry disrupted artificial intelligence is criminal justice system. So almost all law institutes are trying to get, because they have huge data. All judgments are data. You have to filter it and process it. And this judge who is giving the verdict, he can't give, because they also go by the precedences, what has actually happened. Artificial intelligence can take targeted personalized advertising. That is what exactly meaning. You are a beneficiary of artificial intelligence. You came to this meetup, we have not personally got in touch with you. But you have got through, how you got through? Through the social media and their publicity. Say, Facebook, Cambridge Analytica scandal was bad. But that is what exactly will be happening. How machine learning can boost your predictive analytics? What we are talking about today, the machine learning is going to be boosting your predictive analytics, because what exactly business needs, whether you can predict. Say, for example, in India has a very unique features. We are first in statistical concepts. We have created our national survey institutions, NSS. But what has actually happened? We could not process half of the data which we have collected. All the census data is remaining unprotected, because it has to be linked with the planning process. That we have not done. And that is what exactly. 70% of business leaders state growth as the key source of value from analytics, but only 60 of those leaders have predictive analytic capabilities. What you are going to skill yourself, can you enhance your predictive capability? So what business preventing business from achieving predictive analytic capabilities? The major roadblock is applying the right set of tools. So essentially, these data applications of all these things is a integration of this one. Forms of data analysis could be, there are three forms by which data analysis through artificial intelligence and machine learning should take place: descriptive analysis, predictive analysis, and prescriptive analysis. Now, what will happen? All these three functions will integrate in terms of the data science applications. Now, I'll just go for this one. The neural network system is a hardware and software mimicked. As machine learning and artificial intelligence landscape evolution, coupled with the business intelligence tools such as we were having, will definitely help you. In data economy, data is the king, and today any business, small, medium and large, has to depend on that. Results of applications I'll give you. Organization technology companies are employing machine learning based predictive analysis, almost all. They are finding machine learning advancements such as neural network and deep learning algorithm can discover the hidden pattern, how you behave. Just like your mother knows, or your wife will be knowing what is happening to you. Similarly, it's a deep learning. Na? Mother knows both the son and daughter so intimately, they can predict what he likes, how he likes, what he has done. I don't know whether you will agree with me. So is the case in which deep learning, they are all deep learning experts actually. My mother used to be, I think she is no more, but I can tell you. More a computer service, this customer service, satisfaction prediction. In this Zendesk uses machine learning algorithm to predict the satisfaction. Say for example, when you travel any place, say take examples of the Singapore Airlines. If you travel by Singapore Airlines or you use an Apple phone, all of you are using. Why? Those who are using, they feel it has the ability to understand you better than anybody. That much of deep understanding of the customers there. Apple will never ask you how good is the phone. So they have launched so many things, you know. I think everything is well researched and then predicted through a business algorithm model. Medical diagnostics, medical professionals can use the program modeling to ML. Because basically what is happening, all our data is remaining untapped. Doctors is not able to process the data. So they need it. They will not come because they are scared of mathematics and statistics. I don't know why. There's nothing to be scared of. If you are getting data of a patient, you should be knowing how to process it. No, because I have taken medicine because I am poor in quantitative skill. I did nothing. If you are poor in quantitative skill, or why then you allow, ask them to collect so much of data and bring it to you? Have you ever seen any doctor in today's Indian context? They go through your diagnostic reports. Huge amount of, see now they have a package, but who is going to use that? For what purpose it is? I think it is better not to have any estimation if you are not able to use that data. E-commerce, using ML, business can predict customer churn. They are totally watching, you see, they look at the Amazon sale, which is happening every now and then it happens. They are trying to understand what is happening, how you are going to behave. Accordingly, they modulate their offer to you. Marketing. There are many examples of marketing, ML to B2B marketing. Common use cases in identifying and acquiring prospects with attributes similar to existing customer. So you get into. So for example, today you know what is the amount of data Kia is trying to get for the Indian customer. You know Kia, na? The car manufacturer. Now they are trying to get what is their preference, why they should come. There are major challenges Kia has to acquire. Korea people have invested a lot. And I think it's in a bad time when they might have invested, or it may be good time, I don't know. I'll give some this is we have done. I have a case which is very use case called Jio, and I am happy somebody is from Jio here also. You have announced, they have announced levying the charge for outgoing calls. Now, why today they have to roll it back? It's a clear case of application of data science. They started feeling that they will be churned. They lose their customer. And they have failed to keep their promise. Review decision within 48 hours. And they have a very solid team in terms of data science. Mr. Ambani, they don't believe on any other decisions which is other than data. All other operators question the Jio promises because they are creating a popular sentiment. What a company, it keeps on lying with the customer. Although all of them are knowing that this can't be continuing years together. Free talk time to 30 minutes to users, they have announced. It's a quick reaction which is possible only when you can justify. No top management team will approve such a shift in the decision process. And that is what exactly GA rolls out scheme, user port out, because they are finding the behavior of the people, they are trying to port it. And the moment they port, huge churn. And it's an error in terms of pricing strategy. I think business has a wide application in terms of all manipulation of data. The concluding observation, data-driven ecosystems, reshaping business with AI. Namitji, unko bolaiye na. Namitji, Bhupeshji ko bolaiye. Bhupesh ko bolaiye na. Abhi hamara ho gaya. More towards the predictive versus judgmental things. It's not prediction. We can talk about it. All the alternatives of human-based judgment that makes prediction very low. One thing is here, human predictions on the evaluative forms are very low end because it cannot really lead you to an accurate suggestion or recommendation. NLP, chatbots, translation services, Alexa, Siri, they are examples of using data science. Get it? Okay. So you have any questions to ask me? All will support better, faster, cheaper decision. A new era will replace the automatic content-centric processes with the AI. So essentially, I don't find any difference between basic concept of AI, data science, and machine learning. All will lead to the other one. That is how it has evolved. I have shown you the evaluation of the stages. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, Mr. Bhupesh is here. He is going to give you additional dimensions about the entire meetup. But I must thank you for coming and on a Sunday afternoon. India is changing. I get a different data sets because I have always seen people on Sunday, they are not willing to extend. Thanks for joining us in the meetup. And then I think we'll continue with this one. Bhupeshji, bye.
Because of the traffic which has grown, now people would still prefer to go in a two-wheeler than to go on a bike.
I fully agree with you. It's okay. A very good, good logic. I think
money has increased. The expendable money the person has got in India has growing.
Okay.
Third factor is the roads, the infrastructure has not changed. If the infrastructure had changed, then probably even poor man's car would have still bought
a
lot of business for
tax. Today, let me also tell you that what exactly is happening if you really concentrate on these examples. It's basically the sentiment associated with data. So data has to be, you see, it's not, nobody is correct. But the question is that it is not the road or the people, but people would like to, we have to better understand people. Therefore, you need to have an unstructured data analyzed.
I agree, but how do you manage the sentiments into your...
That is what exactly is the technology is giving you. Okay. Now you have a deep learning, how your mother manages you, because she has a better understanding of you.
Okay.
Say, for example, your manager has a better understanding of you, and therefore you have to enable that yourself. And but in terms of the deeper understanding, said, this is one. So for the Jio is concerned, I think it was a radical shift, because within 48 hours they have revised their decision.
I just want to mention even the Jio case, when 3 years back when they got in, they had predicted. Now here it is predictive analysis. They put that predictive analysis into play, and they predicted that the IUC charges will be reduced to zero by the government, right? That's why they said, okay, by the time we'll be getting that government regulation of making IUC zero, we would have, you know, given free lifetime calling service, but it did not happen. Now, even the first timeline for the government was 2019, okay, 2019. Now it is 2020, then they will take another review. So that they predicted, but that prediction did not come true. So the entire their logic, their intelligence to say that, okay, we will give you free voice, did not work out.
No, but I'm not questioning you. But the point,
I'm just making a comment. But nothing beyond.
It's well taken. But the thing is that if you are today able to, because an error, you cannot deny that this is an error.
So we are in a very shifting world.
Naturally, and therefore.
A lot of things will change in life.
You see, one thing is there definitely, we are not going for an error-free decision.
Yeah.
It will be subjected to. But we want to minimize it. We want to make maximum optimizations. You see, as a data science student or statistics students, we never want to eliminate data error. What we can do, we can minimize it. You cannot take everything. Say, for example, today you think some actuaries, they only override the things, no?
So, artificial intelligence in all its goodness cannot cross human,
nowhere.
In the case of ISRO, when they were launching the vehicle, at the last moment the project director decided no. Even if the values were not in favor, he still decided to go ahead with the launch.
But my submission to you will be this, that at least we are aware, they have taken all care. Nobody is blaming ISRO.
No, I'm not.
Because they know it's such a complicated thing, anywhere it can go.
No, sir, you're getting me wrong. I'm just making a statement just to say that, yes, AI does reduce a lot of errors.
Error, that's all.
But that is not the end all.
Obviously.
At the end, human intelligence is far, far superior than AI.
See, there's no substitute. You cannot simulate human intelligence.
So can we add one line on the...
I think cognitive reality is essentially your perception. Augmented reality, what you create. Therefore, you see, it's a higher order ability. Say, for example, today all of us need to create an augmented reality. So you can see, I have seen, if you look at
technological
analysis. Now talking, augmented reality gives you a feeling of reality encapsulated in cognitive ability. Okay. But I think, I'm sure, because I know him, he has also listened to you, he will also explain, otherwise I'll also know.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, guys, those who are here and those who are online. So my name is Bhupesh Dharia, and Dr. Gangopadhyay has already set up the context about AI, data science, analytics, right? And I'm glad that you got some very interesting philosophical and scientific discussion, right? AI is more of a philosophy than the science. When this is a highly debatable, when artificial intelligence can really supersede the human intelligence or not, My take is on that this artificial word is useless. There is nothing artificial about that. It's all natural intelligence. When you're using Google Map, what is Google Map? Is it artificial intelligence or is it real intelligence? It's a real intelligence. But will you say Google Map that this is a real intelligent tool? You'll always say this is artificial intelligent tool. Right? So in Google Map, there is nothing artificial. It's a millions of real human being and they are sharing the real data. So you're driving a car, you're driving a bike, you're even walking, you're holding a mobile phone, you're sharing the real data, real intelligence. Whatever intelligence we talk about, it's basically data point. If I say that I have a gut feel, I am a serial entrepreneur, I'm a teacher, most of the time I take a lot of decisions which I feel that a gut feel, because that cannot be defined into linear model. But I have a complex model, lot of complex data which is going into my head, which I am taking. Now, like yesterday I was in Hyderabad, Bangalore, and the panel was discussion on how AI can transform the legal space. And most of the legal professionals, they were in opinion that you can't really beat the Jethmalanis of the world. But one of the vice chancellor of National Law University of Raipur, Dr. Vivekanand told that most of us, we are basically valuing too much and too much obsessed about our individual cognitive capability. And at one point of time, we are also apprehensive about our ability to really control and lose, and that's the reason we are not allowing technologies to really come into the picture. AI essentially is basically is the aggregation of the natural intelligence to take the better decisions, remove the error in any decision making, and that's not only applicable for AI or data science, that's applicable for all kind of education you have gone through, right? So whatever you have studied, statistics, mathematics, engineering, history, commerce, why do you read history? Because you want to really learn from the history that what mistake you made it in 200 years back, we should not really make today. Otherwise, what is the fun of reading this history, why Britishers really captured India? Is there any fun? No, there is no fun, but there is a lesson. So data science, AI is now helping us to really reduce our accuracy. And all these models are probabilistic. Humans do not really take any deterministic decisions. If I ask you, okay, what is your opinion about AI? You will be giving the answer based on your best ability. You will not be giving the answers right or wrong answers. So do I. So most of our answers are probabilistic answers. and that's where this whole AI is much closer to the way human actually thinks. And it's not only AI. It's a combination of IoT, AI, blockchain. It is basically exact replica of how human organism works. So your hands are like these IoT devices, right? If you shake hands with someone, even closing your eyes, you can actually feel whether you want to really trust that person or not, right? And you have a lot of edge analytics which is going on. These eyes, they're working like your cameras, right? Imagine for a while that you're a bio-robots, right? And your mind is basically AI system, right? Imagine that if you're a bio-robot and there is no natural intelligence, which is artificial intelligence. And your nerve system is primarily a telecommunication system, right? So all these systems which we are seeing, they are exactly representation of the human being. Humans can't create something which they have not seen, right? What has happened in last 6 years because of the telecom networks, because of IoTs, because of AI, data science, which is nothing new, which is quite old phenomena. But we reached to a tipping point where all these things have converged for creating a better world. Of course, there are a lot of people will really exploit that. Now, let's move further and we'll further discuss about what AI and what AI cannot really do. But concluding on that, can AI can really supersede the average human intelligence? The answer is yes. And in most of the cases, it has been done. Let's take example of the game called AlphaGo, which is built by DeepMind, which is taken over by Google on $500 million. Now, AlphaGo won over a champion in game called Go. Go is a Chinese game, which is much more complex game than the chess. Chess is a logical game. Scientists always thought that you can really train any AI or machines perhaps on logical steps. But this AlphaGo, there is a documentary on Netflix you should go and watch. This game run for 5 days and AlphaGo won by 4-1. And scientists were shocked that how the hell this happened. And later on they figured out that they have shown millions of moves of multiple players, and AlphaGo learned and devised its own strategy. And that was further shocking. On the day two, this AlphaGo made a move that really gave a shock to this Korean champion Seol, and he was sitting and watching for almost 2.5 hours or 3 hours to really actually make a move. And everybody was shocked that what the hell this kind of move he has made, because no human guy will really make those kind of move. So AlphaGo learned and devised its own strategy, right? And this is not I'm talking about future, this is I'm talking about past. This already happened. So there are almost 100,000 images you can really go and search. These are the fake images which AI system GAN networks has created. And these 100,000 people, they look real, but they're fake. None of them actually exist. I'll show you those images. But yes, in general intelligence, we have not created tools which are exceeding human intelligence at a generic level. But on very specific tasks, in terms of really identifying images, playing games, driving cars, machines are outperforming human accuracy, right? And these are different intelligences, right? And humans have aggregated those intelligence. Like, for example, Watson can read 800 million documents, which is like 80 crore pages reading. I studied one of the best guys, right? So my roomie was like a All India Gate Topper in 95, 98.99 percentile, right? How much pages he used to read about Melbourne Healthcare? Hardly, say, 5 to 6 pages in half an hour. An idiot like me could read hardly 2 pages in half an hour and could not really understand that. Watson can read 800 million documents, 80 crore pages. Can you really imagine that? They can really beat the whole country. Best of the guys in the whole world. And that's how Watson is able to really do the cancer detection in much better way. But doctors, since as Dr. Gangopadhyay said, doctors hate mathematics, hate technology. They will really keep a guard. Like one of my friend, Dr. Geeta, built a system in Niramai. They launched a company in Niramai. Niramai, what Niramai is doing, they use a thermal camera on a mobile phone, attach it, and this Android phone cost you how much? $10,000? 25,000 rupees thermal camera attaches, 35,000 rupees your multi-million dollar device is ready for breast cancer prediction. 2 months back, she got a $6 million funding. These kind of stuff will democratize the way healthcare is being done. So even in shopping mall, standing over there, you just take the photograph, no touch, no intrusion, nothing. Right? Similarly, Watson is doing that. So there are multiple areas, and these areas, like machines, has really outperformed the human being. As a human being, if either we are natural or a biorobot, whichever it is, we'll have our own issues next 100 years. But present and even in the past, machine has given example that we are actually really stupid. So I have the complete agenda. Let's see how much I can really cover. We'll talk about invasion of future in present, immediate past, future use cases, who we are, opportunities in data science, what is data science and AI. Dr. Gangopadhyay has already covered some stuff we spoke. What skills, competencies you require. And at last, my colleagues will tell you how Aegis can really help you to really launch your career in this area. Okay, so we talk a lot about future. I would like to really bust your myth, there is nothing future. Most of the things we were thinking that this will come in future already became a past. Let's see some example. Play.
Konnichiwa, Kento-san.
Volume.
Genki desu ka?
Oh, Japanese. Hi, Pepper.
Wow, there are a lot of people here.
Have you seen this, all of you?
Okay, so okay. Could you introduce yourself?
This is top video.
My name is Pepper.
So this is a Pepper, right? When Pepper was launched, roughly around 2015-16, I met Pepper in Bangalore. And that time I saw Star Wars and I visited Bangalore. Ginny Domiti was there to launch Watson. And Pepper was dancing on singing a song, Gangnam style. I thought all these robots exist in Star Wars. And then I went ahead and shook hands with Pepper. He introduced me. Hi, my name is Pepper. I'm powered by IBM Watson. I love watching movies. I had goosebumps. I said, what the hell is this, right? Because this is good to really watch in movies, but in reality, something different. So, and such kind of scene was there on the stage. This was some other video, wherein Pepper walked on the stage, chatted, had questions, answers, and it was talking like just a human being, right? And this Pepper is a product of Watson, say SoftBank, body is SoftBank, and soul is of Watson. It can really have a conversation like a human being. I won't call it like a robot. I will call it like a humanoid. It has got an intelligence, right? And much faster speed and much better than most of us. Perhaps I will not be blabbering, say, after 5 years. You will be having Pepper kind of robot or Sophia will be teaching you, right? You ask me any deep question, perhaps I may not be answer. But these folks, they can really answer because they have access to the data. Massive amount of the data. We also have a data, but that data is limited to our head, and moreover, our learning capability is very slow. So we have a computer, we have a vision. Vision has a huge input, say data capturing capability, but our processing capability is extremely slow, right? All 7,000 years, humans could not really learn nothing new, right? We have extremely slow speed, but these systems, since they have the massive data stuff, massive processing power, they can really process a lot of data and they can really give a lot of inputs. Similarly, you must have seen Sophia, right? I need not really play that video. Right? How these systems actually work? So they use a lot of speech to text technology. So you speak to them, they will convert your voice into the text and then they run the queries. And for example, you ask who is Mahatma Gandhi, they will run the query about Mahatma Gandhi in millions of documents in servers which is attached Watson servers, and then they will refer some couple of papers where Mahatma Gandhi is referred. So for example, if I have written about Mahatma Gandhi, I have no credibility in history, and some professor of Mumbai University who is PhD and he has written couple of books, he will take his reference and my reference and he will statistically weight my answer as a zero and his answer perhaps like a 10 out of 10 scale. So statistically it will weigh. And then it will really come up with couple of answers and statistically whichever answer is the best answer, it will recommend it to you. And that's how precisely we as a human being works. Right? And humans have created a better human. Let's see from where it is coming. Immediate past. This I'm talking about 2016, 2018. Play video. Huh? Kyun video load nahi kiya? Okay, so this, have you seen the video of Jeopardy? Game called Jeopardy? It is like Indian Bonvita. 2011, IBM built a system called what? Deep Blue, right? And Deep Blue won over a human being, best champions in a game called Jeopardy, which is like a Indian Bonvita, right? Just check other videos, right? So, and from there, just 2012 to say 2015, in just 3 years, a computer software AI became transform itself into humanoid robot, right? Next, PPT, bring it PPT. You should have checked it. Okay, so Let's see where future is going. हाँ क्या हुआ why it is not found open my folder तुम लोग करते क्या हो यार
I even made a new friend. I have a friend. And the absurd thing is she's actually an operating system. Charles left her behind.
Turn off these lights.
She's totally amazing. You know, she's so smart. She doesn't just see things in black or white. She sees this whole gray area and she's helping me explore it and
Volume. They will not be able to hear.
We just bonded really quickly. I'm weird. That's weird, right? That I'm bonding with an OS. No, it's okay. It's weird.
Well, I don't think so. Actually, the woman that I've been seeing, Samantha, I didn't tell
you. Have you guys seen this movie?
She's an OS.
Any of you?
You're dating an OS? What okay. is that like?
So, this movie name is Har. Just stop this movie. From this clip, it looks like a romantic movie. It is a romantic movie. The only crazy part in this movie that this guy, could you recognize this hero? Joker, Jack Quinn. So this movie came in somewhere around 2011 and he falls in love with a mobile OS, not even robot. And that mobile OS name is Samantha. So how this story goes, he buys a mobile phone in future, he opens a mobile phone. Mobile phone knows that this guy is a loner and he's a male and the OS names herself as a Samantha, right? And the OS also knows that he is not a gay, right? So she names herself as a Samantha and they fall in love. So Samantha reads his social media, emails, everything, right? And she becomes, she's not a nagging, more he talks to Samantha, more she understands, right? So Samantha is like a cognitive OS. And I said, what the hell is this? This is something crazy. And then I did some couple of research and then I found that Qualcomm is working on this similar kind of project, which is like a cognitive OS, cognitive chip. And today if we see Siri or Alexa or all those kind of stuff, they are reaching towards those directions. But not fully as they have shown in this movie, Her. Now, every romantic movie has a tragic ending or a good ending, right? What happens in tragic ending?
The lovers die together.
That's extreme, right? Yeah. But yeah, lover dies, right? And it breaks the heart of either both or some one person. This also happens over here. How it happens? Samantha goes for upgrade, right? So crazy movie. But do we have to really wait for the future? Yes, I don't know whether Alexa or Siri, somebody has released this research which says that yes, a lot of people actually propose Alexa for will you marry me, right? So is that happening, right? So future perhaps people will die not because of AIDS or cancer, they will die with loneliness. And these systems will really help. So that's the level of cognitive capability these systems will really build, powered by data, right? Powered by big data. Slide. Okay, play this. तुम लोगों ने किया क्या है उसको पूरा फोल्डर लोड करने के लिए मैंने बोला था ना हैव यू कॉपीड द पीपीटी सेपरेट और वीडियो सेपरेट शो मी फोल्डर यू शुड चेक वेदर इट इज वर्किंग और नॉट अरे शो मी फोल्डर डोंट इरिटेट मी
you speak a word of what I'm about to show you, you will be executed for high treason.
It's beautiful. It's the greatest encryption device in history, and the Germans use it for all communications.
Everyone thinks Enigma is unbreakable.
Let me try, and we'll know for sure.
Mr. Turing, do you know how many died because of it?
I don't.
Three. While we've been having this conversation.
Gentlemen, meet
Mr. Turing.
Will you work together then? Okay. I'm afraid these men will only slow me down.
Popular at school.
Okay, how many have seen this movie? Okay, this movie is Imitation Game. And supposedly computer science and everything, data science, AI started from this point. And this movie is about Second World War, wherein the British Army, they got hold of a device called Enigma. And this Enigma used to have a code with encryption that where Germans are going to really attack. And British Army, they created like a call center kind of scenario wherein best of the mathematicians, cryptographer, they used to decipher this whole code where Germans are going to really attack. And in this process, they hired a mathematician, Cambridge University mathematician called Alan Turing. And Alan Turing realized that humanly it is not possible. If we have to really beat machines, we have to create a machine. Humans are inherently incompetent to beat machines. And that's a very profound statement, and that has become the vision, guiding principle for entire humanity since then. He created supposedly world's first computer. And that's how Allied forces could really break that code and camouflage and win over the Germans. This was a top secret. Moreover, Alan Turing was a gay. He died a shameful death, but in 2006 or 7, Queen recognized him for his contribution for saving the country. And that's how this movie was made. So the history of computer science, data science, cryptography, all this goes pretty long, right? Roughly around 70 years, not pretty long. You should watch this movie, this Imitation Game and Her, right? And these two will give you the extreme ends, where it started and where it is going to go in next 50 years. Billion movies, right? Next. Okay, so let's see what are the use cases. So first, I would like to really talk about government. And Dr. Gangopadhyay also spoke about. So it's not that only AI and data science is used for making money. It's used for better governance. One of the best use case I can really talk about, Government of India deployed a project called iInsight roughly around 4 years back. And what this project was about, to improve the tax collection, right? And stop tax defaults. What they did, they combined very simple project, theoretically very simple, execution-wise very complicated. If you're having the bank account, you're having a PAN card. And people create multiple bank accounts, hundreds of bank accounts to really put their money over there. But if you have a bank account, you're one human being, even if you create 100 bank accounts, the PAN card will be the same. So if you combine, create a single database where you have PAN cards, then all the bank accounts will be linked, and then check whether Ramlal's name is appearing in income tax filers list or not. So you're a Ramlal and all other different banks, your money is 50 lakh rupees, but you're not paying income tax. So income tax department will knock your door and say, are you Amitabh Bachchan's relative? Why you're not paying, right? Is it agriculture income? And that's how income tax revenue started increasing, right? Very simple big data project, Aadhaar card, right? So government can really use it for, say, leakages in the government schemes, revenue, threat prediction, right? Better governance, better traffic control, better transportation, multiple areas. Now, the day I made my Aadhaar card, I realized that my future for doing any kind of cyber crime is over, or any kind of physical crime, because government is having my fingerprints, iris data, face data, everything, right? Somebody else can really do that crime, but I can't really do, and I may go jail. But personally, I can't really do. That's not possible, and none of you. Now, today, even creating a second Aadhaar card with different name, fake name, using your fingerprints is impossible, right? The system will really tell. This massive amount of the data can help government to really have the better governance. It can also help government to really control. Let's take example of China. China created a social rating system. In social rating system, for example, you have some dubious friends, those who are booked in, say, robbing or maybe in traffic violation or some fraud or other stuff, and they're connected with the social network, or perhaps you're meeting them in CCD and their cameras, and they will really reduce your social rating, right? To the extent that you will not be able to even board the flight, your kids will not get the admission in colleges and schools, right? You speak against government, now this is extreme side. If you speak against government, you're a journalist, you will not be able to board your flight, your kids will not get the admission. So they're using it in a different way, which primarily was created to really have the better, like just like a your CIBIL rating, right? So they also created a social rating, which can really greatly use to control, to predict the crime, to stop the crime, but at the same time suppress you, right? So these are the extreme forms, and that's the perhaps reason Hong Kong is paranoid about that. There is a company, let me show one movie clip. Chalega ya nahi chalega?
All of you. All of my men are volume. Standing by and are fully at your disposal.
My volume is slow. Okay, have you seen this movie? You must have seen, all of you. This is pretty recent movie. My volume is low. Okay, so in this movie, anybody seen this movie? Can you really tell me why I'm showing you this movie clip? Yeah, God's Eye. And what is God's Eye? Anybody can tell me? What is God's Eye? God's Eye is like some illusionary system which they are talking about, which can really hack into any of, say, CCTV camera around the world. If, for example, I want to really find you, I have your pictures, and then I will feed this picture into the system, and then with this God's Eye, I can really hack into the world network of CCTV cameras, plus even mobile phones, cameras. And I will be able to hunt you down. Now, does any kind of system exist? Universal system? The answer is no. But does it exist in pockets? The answer is yes. So today you do go to Beijing or say London, it is practically impossible to even plant a bomb, because every street corner they are watching. Earlier they were analyzing it manually. Now today with deep learning, they are doing it automatically. So if I really feed your images in real time, I can really hunt you down, right? Even in Mumbai, now the traffic police is reading your number plate, right? If you do any traffic violation, you will be penalized, right? So when they can really read your traffic plate, they can read your face as well. So this infrastructure is there. The smart city infrastructure is already there, but not many smart city projects are actually using your face to detect it, right? Because there are a lot of privacy laws and other stuff are there. But basic infrastructure is right in the place. And what they're using is typically computer vision, right? They're using video analytics. And this computer vision is nothing new. Computer vision is quite old, but computer vision got huge acceptance and the better accuracy, better speed since 2012. And when Jeffrey Hinton, godfather of deep learning in University of Toronto, he along with his other student, they did major breakthrough in this research. Moreover, companies like Nvidia offered GPUs, right? So combined power of GPUs, better processing, a lot of labeled data, and the breakthrough which was done by Jeffrey Hinton and his students, this computer vision backed up by deep learning skyrocketed, right? So the systems were in place, but they were not doing this level of massive video analytics. And this has really gone to a different level. And today it has gone to a level wherein with gate networks you can actually create a fake videos. So I can take your sample voice, I can take your sample video, and I can really create a fake video. So tomorrow's data scientists and AI guys and cybersecurity guys will have a absolutely a different kind of problem. Not only that you have to really create those kind of system, but you have to really detect. Imagine that you are working in Naukri. Let me show you something scary, right? Just a minute. Very interesting stuff. Okay, look at these pictures. You can see? Guys, those who are online, you can also see. You can see? These looks like a real face. I have 100,000 such face in my Google Drive. How many? 100,000. None of them actually exist. They all are fake. They all are fake. And they're created by GAN networks. How many? 100,000. Can you really create 100,000 fake profiles on shadi.com? It will create a chaos. You can create a million fake profiles. You can, when you can really create images, you can create fake addresses. You can create fake names looking like a real names. All nationality, all colors, black, white, gray, brown, everything, right? Now, so it's not that only you will be creating the systems, and that's where deep learning, machine learning is going to play a massive role into cybersecurity. And so it's not only that you are going to really protect your database or network or application, you will have a different kind of threats. Now, let's go back to the shadi.com case. If you create 100,000 fake profiles or 500,000 or a million fake profile, valuation of shadi.com immediately shoots up. And imagine that they also float a chat, right? And these guys, these fake profiles start chatting to you. You have no understanding, and a fake profile is chatting to the fake profile. That's extreme end, right? But a fake profile is chatting to the real profile, right? The kind of agony you will go through, right? Later on you realize that such a person does not exist. Now, there is a chatbot which helps depress people to calm them down. And that chatbot actually talks you just like a human being. How are you today? Why are you feeling upset? What did you do? Did you had a coffee? Okay, what did you had a argument with your friend? It just chats to you like a human being. And millions of people are chatting. So the cognitive chatbots can really talk to you like a human being. So we are talking about absolutely a different world. Are we talking about future? This is created like almost a month back. A month back. So I'm talking about past. And might be there are some places where fake profiles are being created. So it is already being reported on Facebook or Twitter. All those places you have millions of fake profiles. Fake people are chasing Mr. Modi, right? Millions of fake bugs, right? You don't know whether they exist or not. So who is going to really solve this problem? The cybersecurity guys or the data scientist guys or AI guys or IoT guys or network security guys? So old models of cybersecurity is gone. So we started the first most comprehensive cybersecurity program last year in Bangalore, and we launched that program here in Bombay as well. And that cybersecurity program, we have included machine learning and deep learning and Python. So not only when I did my engineering that time, it was only network security, right? But there are hundreds of companies which offers the network security. So today the security has gone to absolutely different level. So if you study only network security, database security, application security, people will make you fool like this. Today attacks are being done by machines. Dynamic attacks your mind cannot really comprehend. You'll say that these are the random IP addresses the attack is coming. But even in that randomness, there is a pattern, which human mind cannot really decode at a fast speed, which machine learning can really do. Right? So all this world is converged. So today, people think that blockchain is safe. No, there is a security breach which can happen in a blockchain. So you need to be aware about blockchain security. You need to be aware about IoT security. If somebody hacks into the IoT devices, they can blast the oil refinery. They can blast the oil pipeline. You'll not see that the temperature is exceeding beyond certain level, but that is happening. So today, all these fields are converged. And by the way, in data science field also, those who get the highest paid in data science are basically specialized in cybersecurity. Right? It's not only simply building up machine learning models. Anyway, AI data science is also used in terms of really crime prevention. And this is one project which we initiated at Aegis. This project name is called Khojo. Now, child trafficking, woman trafficking, roughly around $500 billion business worldwide. But the kind of loss it can really incur to any society or a country, there's no estimation. My estimation is roughly it brings a loss close to almost $6 to $7 trillion. Right? if your society is not safe, why do you think that no company goes and invests in Patna or Bihar? Why do you think? It's not safe. If you go over there, if your child is abducted, what are you going to do with that money? Why Singapore is so safe? Why Singapore is so safe? Every street and corner, there is a money. Does the businessmen do not think that trafficking can also lead business to them? But they have measured that the losses versus the profit, the losses are much more than the profit. And that's the reason they stop. So there's no morality in that. So we realize that data science and AI can be used to stop child trafficking. What we did, we created this platform. This is called Khojo app, right? What this app does, you take a photograph of any child who is roaming around on the street and take a photograph. Let me take your photograph. Okay, your photograph is over here. And let me upload it. Right? So this is taking the geolocation, right? And bingo, done, uploaded. Imagine that you're a child, you're abducted from Rachi, right? You're a 5-year-old kid, and you're roaming on the street. I took your photograph, uploaded it. Your parents launched your complaint a month back. They launch a complaint in police station. Police guy writes a FIR and uploads your photograph through this system, which police department got the interface. And uploads your parents' Aadhaar card detail, mobile number, everything. Now, once I upload this photograph, imagine I really found you on a street. This hits to cloud, and it does the facial recognition, facial match, and then it sends an alert to the police station from where the complaint was launched, the police station, nearest police station over here, NGO, because kids cannot be held back into police station, and then the parents, right, four parties. These NGOs will be verified by the police station. Simple logic, bingo, done. But technology is very small piece, and even in technology, it's a very complicated technology, because those who know about machine learning a little bit, you don't have the sample data, right? And you'll take the photograph from the distance. The photograph will not be clear, right? And their face will be covered or blackened, or you don't know, right? So it will not be in perfect situation. But we are working on that, and those who want to really contribute into this project, you're most welcome. So we hire interns, you can volunteer, you can create social awareness, you can really create awareness groups. And this project we are doing under the data science and AI for the social good. What it means that we don't want to make money. So this entire software piece, this entire project is available free of cost for any government, any society, any civic body. You use it free of cost. But the government need to really come. Public need to be aware. There are 450 million smartphone users in this country. Worldwide, there are roughly around 3.5 billion smartphone users, which is roughly around half the world's population. Who made Google? We made Google. even 10% Indian start using it, in next 2 months time, child trafficking, woman trafficking will be written as a part of history, which as a society, we accepted that this is a necessary evil which is going to really happen. Bombay, ironically, this is the worst place for trafficking. Trafficking happens right in our neighborhood and our life goes on. That's a bitter reality. Technology can really do something? Yes, technology can really do something. I've been talking to, two weeks back, I was in Delhi, spoke to COI, talking to the operators, take this app everywhere, and you can actually get the brownie point, and we will not be charging any money on that anyway. So there's a lot can be really done in terms of improving the quality of life, better governance, threat prediction. There's a company, Prepol in US, they reduce crime rate by roughly around 60%. And they're not taking any personalized data. If I take your personalized data, I can actually predict when you're going to do your suicide. If I take your DNA data, your history, family history, and all those stuff. But there are a lot of privacy issues. So what they're doing, they're just analyzing the crime pattern. So it occurs to us, common sense, that okay, crime may happen at some place which is dark, remote place, when the rain is going on. We see it typically in movies. It's a dark place and the ATM is there, most likely you can be robbed. So they analyze the data, what is the pattern? If you are going for a party and you updated that you're going for a party and there's nobody at home, Friday night, most likely that thief can enter your home. So they analyze this whole data pattern and based on that they predict where crime might happen so that police department can really reallocate their resources. Right? And just simple analytics, there's nothing big data, there's nothing like a highly sophisticated AI, simple machine learning algorithms, they could really predict and they could really reduce down the crime rate. Fair enough? Okay, e-commerce. Most of us, we are aware how e-commerce are really making money. The simple example is recommender systems, which most of us are aware. Any idea what kind of commercial impact this is bringing on e-commerce companies? One third of their revenue comes out of recommender system. Snapdeal, there are 25 million customers, 5 million products. Amazon, there are 160 million customers, which is bigger than Russia's population. 5 billion products. How many products? 5 billion products. And when you really go and search for a white shirt, you don't get a pink recommendation. And so what they have done, they created this. This is called data product. You can also call it AI. They automated the whole analytical process, right? And that's the beauty of AI. And through which they are able to really cater to the each individual customers. Right, and recommender system is nothing but it's the outcome of machine learning systems. Now, what is Amazon's revenue? Roughly around $450 billion. One third revenue comes out of this. So if I'm a chairman of the board, I can fire the CEO in 2 minutes time, but I can't touch half a dozen or a dozen data scientists, those who actually build this recommender system and fine tuning it. It's not that you once build and it will work for forever. Right, you have to keep on fine-tuning your algorithms, keep on changing the parameters. Right, but definitely every day you will not rewrite the code. Imagine that, say, Amazon is an official partner for OnePlus. Right, OnePlus is sold through the Amazon. Now, do all of you get the emails about OnePlus? If OnePlus is being launched, should Amazon need to really send an email to all 160 million customers? Why not? Is their data? I can just click a button and send it. Why not? Airtel is having 300 million customers. Airtel comes up with a plan, 1 terabyte, 100 rupees, hypothetical. Will they send SMS to all 300 million customers? Yes or no? No, why no? We all know the reason.
Like if you have certain products, you might want to reduce the traffic to
Why you want to reduce the traffic? You want as many as customers you want. Okay, it's not about traffic. There's no regulation.
It's a cost to company.
It's a cost to company. But why it is cost to company? But you're generating the revenue. If all 160 million customers buy OnePlus, then it really surpasses your cost. They send to very specific customers. Why very specific customers?
They are the potential buyers. So
yeah. Yeah. So, do you any of you get the Mercedes or Lexus or BMW advertisement on Facebook? Huh? Or any top brand? You don't, because Mark Zuckerberg knows that you will not buy. Right? So it's called customer segmentation. Why you would like to really send SMS or email to every customer? You'll send to only those who are likely to really buy. Because there is a cost. At the same time, if you really send email to everybody, your spam will increase. Let's come to Facebook. If you can buy a bicycle, why I should show you the ad for Mercedes-Benz? Right? Because Mercedes will lose the money. You'll click on the ad on the Mercedes. You will anyway will not buy. This is a fake lead. And the customer, the client will lose the money if you click on the ad of the Mercedes. Mercedes will be paying say 10 rupees, 5 rupees, 250 to 300 rupees. And if they don't get the conversion, if they get the bad lead, they perhaps switch to Twitter or maybe Google or some other platform. So the whole AI revolution actually started not to really cure the cancer or bring the world better. It's basically to build systems which ad you're going to click next, ironically. But now it is used in multiple places. So this is about segmentation. So now you can really segment your customers. Right? Send campaign to only those who are likely to buy. Fair enough? Okay. And that's how e-commerce companies are using. Shopping cart abandonment, right? So you go on, say, make my trip or clear trip, you're just booking a ticket, airline ticket, and then you exit. And then immediately, all of a sudden, you will get a call. Sir, you were trying to book a flight from Bombay to Delhi. I'm holding that flight on the same rate, 6,000 rupees. You don't have to really pay, but sir, the price is increasing, right? I will send you the link. Or you can tell me the credit card details, I will book a ticket for you. Right? How it is happening? Data science, right? So customer segmentation, improving the customer experience, better recommendations, right? All e-commerce companies are using, not only e-commerce, almost every other company. Even banks are using it. Let's see telcos. Jio came. Lot of companies died down. Idea Vodafone has to marry together, right? And still this marriage is not saving them. Airtel is bleeding. So Jio came, they started building the big data infrastructure. They hired a guy called Nikola from Sweden, right? They built one of the best data science team. They built one of the world's largest big data infrastructure. So they have the customer data about everything. They have the data about the towers, how the towers are performing, how the networks are performing. So they clearly one of the strategy they use, one of the important strategy is to play with the data and get the right data at the faster speed. Other players, they failed on that. Other players were traditional doing the traditional analytics for churn prediction. One of the area where it is used for churn prediction. What is churn? Customer A leaving from company A to B. So customer from Vodafone left Vodafone and joined Jio. That's a full churn. Part churn, like for example, I was using the data of Vodafone and now I am not using the Vodafone data, I am using the Jio data, but I am using the voice of Vodafone. This is a part churn. So all these companies were using the traditional churn model and traditional churn model failed them. Vodafone Idea, they could not really predict that this much churn will really happen, right? And then that really led to their collapse. And a lot of other factors as well, which is like regulation, pricing, aggressive pricing, better infrastructure. But data science and AI, big data, has played a very major contributing factor. And once Vodafone realized that they are losing the war, I have seen that. Katia Walsh, who was the global head for analytics of Vodafone, requested me that we need to really hire the big data head for India. And subsequently, they hired Dr. Paul, now who is the current head. He was the head for SAP. He was the chief data scientist of SAP in Ireland. They hired him. Airtel, Sunil Mittal hired a gentleman, Dr. Shantanu, from NASA, right? But by the time the damage was done, massive damage was done, right? Telcos are using for network cost optimization. Each tower, if you have to put one tower, it costs you roughly around 50 lakh. Now, can I use proper analytics to find that how many towers I have to really put? Instead of 100 tower, can I really manage my network with 80 tower? This is a huge saving, right? Infrastructure cost is a sunk cost. You can't really, it's gone, right? So you can't really go and sell the tower. Companies like Reliance Communication, Reliance Infra, GTL Infra, just gone bankrupt because they sunk in a lot of money in infrastructure, right? And the asset value depreciates massively. So it is used for planning your infrastructure, optimizing your infrastructure, doing prediction in dynamically, how do you really reallocate your traffic, right? It is for churn, it is for customer segmentation, it is for having the better customer experience in call centers, right? Now, this Watson is being used in a lot of call centers. So you talk to human beings, they behave based on the emotional state they are. If you're hungry, you will behave irritative. But machines will not behave that way. Machines, more you talk to the machines, machine will become more intelligent. And this Watson is now deployed in a lot of call centers. Right? In India, most of the call centers are not using, but they started using a lot of voice automated systems. But in next 5 years, 10 years, you'll see that you'll not be talking to humans, you'll be talking to the machines. And machines will be in much better position to really respond to your queries. Imagine a scenario wherein, like, because machine can interface other machine in much better way. So if you're talking to the machine that, okay, what is the status about my billing? Or what is the status about my complaint which I learned that my signals are not really working? Machine can really access the data which is in other machine as compared to the human being, because human being have to really query and then really get those responses. So that's where the call center industry will look like in next 10 years time, right? So roughly around 80% human being, those who are working in call center industry in next to 10-15 years will be completely wiped out. They have to do some other job. India, the cost is low, but it's still like 35,000 or 40,000 rupees per seat. Its cost is not low, right? Machines can really work at much lower cost. So the next big revolution which will be coming in this space is like a conversational AI. So say 25 years back, everybody wanted to really have the website, which we did it in last 20 years, 25 years. Now, everybody who has a website, they will like to really have the conversational AI, right? Because that's the way human being works. So I would not really go and type that I want a laptop with black laptop with 16 GB RAM and 1 TB hard disk, less than 90,000 rupees. That's a natural way of really doing, but you, this is unnatural way that you really go and filter, select the filters and do that. That's an absolutely unnatural way. And that's where this conversational AI will come into the picture. And what this conversational AI can really do, I need not really tell, right? What Alexa or Siri or Google is really doing in that space. And again, thanks to this deep learning, which has actually exponentially improve the accuracy of speech to text, text to speech, and the language translation kind of scenario, right? There is another very interesting use case is location-based service. So by the time this meetup will finish, you might be feeling hungry. So Vodafone or Jio or any of the operator knows precisely plus minus 5 meters distance that where you are. They know better than Google that what is your income because they read your SMS. Right? So based on their income, based on their location, they can really tell you whether you will get a 20% discount in Renesa or say 20% discounts in MACD. So hey, like, are you feeling hungry? Here is a 20% discount, go and show this coupon and we'll get the dinner and plus 2 beer free at Renesa or 1 burger free at 20% discount, something like that. And they can really make a huge, huge, huge amount of the money. I've been teaching telecom management for last 15 years. In my opinion, Indian operators are idiots. They've never actually done that. They were in better situation than most of the Google or the e-commerce companies because they precisely know their customer and they already have the wallet because of the postpaid scenario. But hopefully companies like Jio will really do, but other operators, they're pathetic. They didn't do that. But worldwide, there are a lot of operators are actually offering the location-based services. They're giving exposure of their API, just like Facebook or Twitter, what they do. They give the interface wherein you can really design your own campaign, all right? I remember one guy was trying to really do this job. I forget his name, he's a Brit guy. Was trying to really build something in Vodafone. But that project didn't take off because most of the telcos are run by oldies, right? And they protect their guard. They thought that it is about voice business. Jio came and thrashed that. This is not about voice business. Anyway, so that's a big, big, big potential. Still, operators are sleeping on that. Education, this is one of my favorite area. Education, we have done a lot of work. So personalized education. So today, this meetup is not personalized. So irrespective, the experience is wide range, expectation is wide range, but we are giving you the same content. And there is very fine tuning, very little fine tuning is in that. How about we can really offer you the content based on your individual need? How about your BE computer science curriculum can be designed based on the individual need? Because some people like to learn from the practical, some people like to really learn from the theory. The assessment model can be different, the lesson plan can be different. Theoretically it is possible, logistically it is a nightmare, and that's the reason it has never been done. And even if you have to really do that, you need to really know a student just like your mother, and you need to really have a lot of data. And that's where MOOC platform, they're having a huge amount of the data, and that's where Coursera or Udemy can actually send you personalized recommendation about the courses, if not personalized course path, which eventually they will be able to really do. So we also run another company called MUni, and then some significant work we have done over there. So this is like a MUni app. Most of you, when you join Aegis, you really get this kind of app, right? And that's where like we have chatbots, and then you communicate and you share a lot of content, and that's how we actually get to know what you're using, right? We created the learner's analytics. We have complete insight how much time you're spending on video or PDF or Word document, which video you're liking, which video you're not liking. So a lot of insights we are building. And hopefully by next year, we'll showcase you some of the good work on personalized learning. Other work which is very interesting work, which is learners analytics. Very few companies around the world, including SAP and Microsoft, they're doing this work on learners analytics. Let me show you how this learners analytics looks like. This is like a snapshot of a crude learners analytics. Now, if you see, you'll find typical attendance level, 2 attendance, 78 and 47. These are mark red, right? Majority of the attendance, you'll see it in the range of 100%. Have you seen this kind of attendance figure anywhere? Now I'll tell you why, what is the reason, right? Today we can really actually predict which candidate is likely to fail, which candidate is not likely to fail. This analytics is also available to the recruiters, right? So recruiters can really see how many assignments they have done, what is the quiz, how many visits they have done, how much time they have spent, right? What is their progress, and those kind of stuff. Let me show you some of other work which we did. One of the interesting work we did, you are attending this meetup for data science and AI. How many of you want to make your career in this area? Okay, good. Any idea how many jobs are there? Or any idea what kind of skills you require to become a good data scientist? Any idea? I know most of the data scientists in this country, and one of the best guys are in our board. 2015, when we started this course, even today, if you really go and talk to, say, 100 people, 100 data scientists, they will talk 100 things, right? And there will be very little commonality in terms of what skill set you need to really acquire. Higher the experience, higher the bias. Lower the experience, further it really degrades. So you can't really completely rely on human brain. So I'll tell you a little longer story. So roughly around 2013, Dr. Xavier, who was the director of IIM Ranchi, he requested us. He's known to Dr. Gangopadhyay, a good friend of mine. So he told us that deliver our PGP in business analytics. We agreed because IIM Ranchi was having a location disadvantage. So our job was to deliver the course, not to design the course. We delivered the course. There were around 40 students. And after 6 months, none of them were happy. The only happiness was that they got the IIM Ranchi tag, which they can really hang on their neck. But the real value they did not really get, because they were taught some operations research or statistics, which most of them anyway knew, or SPSS. They were not taught about big data or machine learning, which is required in the modern world. And 13, 14 is not a long back. And that's where we decided that we have to really do something new. And we've gone back to our original approach when we started in 2002 with Bharti Airtel support. We said, we'll design the curriculum from fresh. We'll not speak to any of the academic institutions which are there in India. The darker secret about how the curriculums are designed in India and around the world, particularly in India, you get some top 20-30 institutions, put somebody to do research, put those curriculum in different 20 Excel sheets, and then create your own sheet. So Ramlal Mohanlal Institute of Technology, and then Ramlal Mohanlal Institute of Technology, and call your faculty members and say, okay, what you can teach? Okay, this subject, what you can teach? Marketing analytics. And then you create your curriculum. Bingo, done. Right, and that's how the curriculum was created. And to give a good outlook, you create your board, which has got 5 industry people, 5 academic people, right? And then done. And that's how the curriculum was designed. So we realized that this is not how the curriculum can be designed. If we are offering the data science, it need to be based on the data. So that time I did my research. I analyzed roughly around 450 jobs about data scientists, analyzed what common skill sets are there. And I did it in manually, put it in the Excel sheet. And then we realized that there's some common skill set which is needed in most of the jobs. Two extreme jobs which I got, like, for example, ATOS. ATOS Global Data Scientist job only asked the requirement for SQL. That was an outlier. That was extreme. But we realize that most of the jobs, they are quite different, but there's some commonalities. And those, what are the common skill set? We analyze that they require R or Python, mathematics, linear algebra, statistics. Hadoop was started coming, machine learning, Hadoop. Deep learning was not so prominent at that point of time, and NLP. And visualization tool, right? So these were couple of common skill set we could really analyze, and that's how we created the curriculum. 2 years back, we took this to a different level. And what motivated, of course, our course curriculum, but at the same time, UNDP, so I met Clement, who was a UNDP head in India, and UNDP's job is to advise Indian government where they're going to really invest money for what kind of a skill set. And one blind man was advising the other blind man. This was a scenario. So neither UNDP knows that what skills is needed. They had no idea. So we said, okay, can we really apply big data and data science to really do this kind of analysis? And that led to this project. Open this link. Click on this link. Click on that link again. हाँ मैंने ईमेल तुम्हें भेजा लिंक का खोला तुमने लिंक चेक योर ईमेल आई हैव सेंड यू लिंक्स हाँ नीचे वाला दूसरा लिंक खोलो ओके सो वी एनालाइज रफली अराउंड 300,000 जॉब्स विच इज़ अवेलेबल इन द मार्केट एंड दिस इज़ व्हाट वी गॉट द एनालिटिक्स So there are roughly around 26,000 jobs available in the market. NESCOM says 1.5 lakh. I don't know from where they got the data, but this is based on the real data. I'm not trying to really claim that this is the real number, but real number will be 10-15% plus or minus. But 26,000 jobs is a huge job, unfulfilled jobs. And these jobs, this is a cluster of jobs of machine learning, big data, data science, analytics, and all those areas. And what skills you require, the most important skill set is Python, not SAS. SAS used to be important skill 2012 or 2013. 2015 when we started, instead of Python, R was there. Now Python's R slided down over here. How many jobs are in Python? Let's check. ₹19,000 jobs are there in Python. Right? Now, let's see, other skill is SQL. SQL is more important than big data, by the way, because the world still works on SQL, right? But Hadoop is also here, Hadoop and Spark, right? Let's see machine learning. How many jobs are machine learning? ₹5,900 jobs are there, 6,000 jobs today, unfulfilled jobs in machine learning. And where this machine learning skill is needed? Data scientist, software engineers, software developer. If you combine these two, software field requires more number of machine learning engineers than even data scientists. So the myth number two, what is myth number two? That machine learning or data science or AI is a separate career field. No, they are not. So today, even if you want to become a software engineer, you can't really just build rule-based softwares, you need to create the smart softwares. And that's what EY and ESCOM survey about job, which says that in by 2020, roughly around 9% of India workforce, which is 600, means roughly around 60 million people, their job will not exist. And roughly around 35% guys of this 600 million will require to undergo a different kind of skill set. This job designation will remain same. So you may remain as a software developer, you may remain as a network engineer, or you may remain as a marketeer, but your underlying skills are going to really change. So whether you're in management, whether you're in technology, your underlying skills are going to really change, right? So this tells you, this is like a, on our site, you can really go and check, right? So this is how we really build our curriculum. So we don't really bring our biases. It's a purely on data. 15 R was on the first term. Now, since last year, we shifted R to the third term and Python became the first term. SQL was elective. Now SQL has become a core course, right? So we give more emphasis on SQL than the Hadoop and Spark. Fair enough? When Factorial comes for recruitment, Factorial needs 2-3 skill set: machine learning, Python, and SQL. Bingo, done. Right? No Hadoop, no Spark. But I'm not saying it is not important, because it is there. So if you see, this Hadoop ecosystem is here, right? Hadoop and Spark. These are two. So roughly around 2,000 jobs are there in Hadoop and Spark, which is very critical. So based on this, we design the curriculum. And that's the reason when you go on our site and you see which my team is going to release, share you, we have a monstrous curriculum. We have a core courses, we have elective courses. So we just don't buy this thing, okay, that you just do machine learning and Python and then you're done. Then you can really solve the world's problem. No, it is not. Anyway, this recommender system. So there is another thing which is which we build in education, which is working. It's called recommender system. So this is a student dashboard, right? Now, we built this recommender system. Who did this? Our faculty members, students. So which course you have joined, whether it is data science or BE computer science or MBA marketing, based on the your degree program, based on the courses you're doing, based on the skill set, based on the grades you're acquiring in each courses, and maybe you have done additional courses on say Coursera or edX, you add those skill set, it will give you those recommendations. So you don't have to really go on Naukri or Monster. This whole system is deployed by Government of Goa. So all the institutions in Government of Goa are running on our platform. So I run two companies, this MUni, involved in two areas, MUni, which is a separate ed tech company, and Aegis School of Data Science. But Aegis has a lot of AI and data science projects developed for the MUni, right? So let's bring back on the slide. So education, it is heavily being used. And 2 months down the line, we'll show you the automated career advisor, which is powered by AI, right? Completely powered by AI. Okay, let's see how it is being used in banking. So the biggest way in banking, because the 54% of the revenue in AI analytics data science comes from the banking, finance, insurance. Why? Because they generate the money and they need to really protect their asset. So, for example, you're using credit card, if you're doing a transaction not more than 1,000 rupees, all of a sudden you do the 50,000 transaction, the bank will send you the alert, right? That, hey, it is you who has done this transaction, and now they have automated voice call. Zero, press 01, and then your transaction will stop or will go through, right? So, in fraud detection, they use. In terms of your creditworthiness, whether we should really give you the loan or not, they use it. A lot of fintech companies, they are building up a model for those who are unbanked and they don't have any credit history. How do you really give them the loan? And that's the kind of problem fintech companies are solving. And how they are solving, they read your SMS, right? So you may be really buying stuff on e-commerce, maybe you're doing the recharge, and based on that transactions, they really build some model, right? And they really build a model that whether you can be given a 5,000 rupees loan or 20,000 or a lakh rupee loan, even you don't have the CIBIL scoring, right? So that's where companies like, say, CreditVidya, they are doing extremely good job in this area. Today, HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank, they all are recruiters, right? So they're heavily hiring data scientists to build this risk models, do the fraud analytics, right? Build recommender systems. Do the customer segmentation, because banks are also having the customer. They have the same problem which we spoke about, right? Healthcare, right? So I gave you the example of this Niramai, right? Watson. Watson, what Watson is doing, so there is a chain of hospitals. What is this chain in Bangalore? Manipal, right? So Manipal adopted Watson, and this is long back, almost three, four years back. So what they're doing, they're training Watson on detecting the cancer. So what happens, most of the cancer detection and care facilities are centered around metros. And they travel all the way. So have you ever been to Tata Memorial Hospital? I will recommend go over there and see the misery of patient. You cannot be treated, but you are just waiting over there to get diagnosed, right? So why somebody should really travel from Bangladesh or Rachi to all the way Bombay? And when you are a third stage, so you upload your diagnostic reports. Most of these reports are digital reports. And since Watson can really read 800 million documents, thousands of research papers are every day being published. Doctors don't have to really read those papers. Watson can really give you a couple of recommendations that, yes, you have a throat cancer, third stage. These are the possible options of treatment, chemotherapy, this much dose, radiotherapy, this much dose, 4-5 options. And the local doctor can really administer those doses. And local doctor will discuss these findings with the senior doctors in metros. And then they will really endorse that, yes, this is right, this is wrong. Because it's still human intervention is needed. It's not that they are replacing doctors. Cure AI, which is a factorial analytics company, Cure AI, what they have done, analyze millions of say x-rays. If I give you two x-ray, one x-ray where my hand is normal, the other one is in two pieces. Even without being a doctor, you can really analyze. But there are a lot of gray shades between these two extremes, right? And that's where the radiologist comes into the picture. But radiologists can really analyze and really train machines, right? They have the commands you feed into the system. And now today, Cure AI system is able to really do the job at much faster rate than the radiologist. Right, because they can really work fast. And the learning is transferable. And that's an amazing beauty. So AI data science is going to democratize the healthcare system. America is spending roughly around $3.5 trillion on healthcare. How much? $1.3 trillion. And still America is having one of the worst healthcare system around the world. What is $3.5 trillion? India's GDP is $3.3 trillion. After spending this much of money, America is still a sick country. You have to really wait for months to really get the appointment with the doctor. Quality of doctors is horrible, right? And you can't really produce as many doctors as possible. But you can really transfer that knowledge of the doctors to the machines, and machines can really do that aggregation work easily, right? Okay, retail again. So you walk into any retail store, you find every 6 months you go, they change the layout. How it has happens? They do the heat mapping, they analyze. When you really go on billing counter, you see that they put chocolates and other stuff, right? Why they do that, right? Let me show you a movie how the future of retail will look like.
4 years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like if you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go? What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store so you never have to wait in line? No lines, no checkouts, no registers. Welcome to Amazon Go. Use the Amazon Go app to enter. Then put away your phone and start shopping. It's really that simple. Take whatever you like. Anything you pick up is automatically added to your virtual cart. If you
Okay. So Amazon Go is already there. We are not talking about future. Yeah, for us it is the future because we don't have this kind of stuff. But imagine that you are in Walmart, and Walmart are like a football stadium, and you want to buy an egg or you want to buy something, and for which you have to really walk for 200 meters. Why you should do that? So the moment you enter, these cameras detect your face and tells you, okay, welcome Ramlal, and do you want to really buy eggs? Go in this direction. And here you can really buy, right? So those kind of stuff is not long far away, right? These are immediate realities which are going to be possible. Automobile, of course, the big thing is Tesla, driverless car. Today our students are working in Ford's, Mercedes. Ford has built one of the largest AI centers in US. Dashboards are becoming much and much smarter. They're using a lot of IoT devices. But IoT devices is only the data which is collection. Any IoT devices without a brain is of no value, right? And that's where the data scientists and AI guys are playing a major role. Other than like what model, how much car you will sell, what price you will sell, those are traditional analytics which is being done, right? Okay, insurance. What premium I should really charge you, right? Like, so today, the way you are driving a car, I can really penalize you. So if you are a rash driver, I have a data, and I can really charge extra premium from you. The government body can really cancel your license, right? Those kind of stuff is pretty possible. Insurance companies, they are able to really find the fraud. So if they find that there's some particular area from where the insurance claims are coming more, they can really get deeper into those areas, right? And they can really find. hospitality industry is using massively. So you go on Make My Trip, they give you good recommendations. You go on booking.com, they give you the better recommendations, right? So if you searching for some hotels in, say, maybe in Bangalore, and you don't select, immediately you'll get an email after a minute or two, right? So okay, you booked the hotel, how about your flight? Or you booked the flight, but are you really looking for some accommodation, right? So those kind of stuff, these AI systems are able to really generate. And that's what next back section, right? So you did this, what should be the next back section? And that's where, say, reinforcement learning kind of stuff they're using. This is a simple chatbot deployed. So I met the founder, he's an Indian founder. They are running it, they have deployed this chatbot in thousands of hotels in US, which improves the customer experience, replace the human dependency, and if this chatbot is not able to really understand what the customer is asking, this will refer it to the human being, right? This is the past, right? This will really go on, say, conversational AI kind of stuff. Any questions so far? Do you really get peek into the future?
Getting the apps developed, that too on mobile first roadmap only. Is that what Aegis is mostly doing, or it's doing something?
Come again?
Preparing, building apps and making them available on mobile versions only. Huh. Is that what Aegis is so far doing on priority?
Okay, I'm coming on Aegis. So far.
I mean, so these apps are examples.
These are everything, they are not all of Aegis. So, education, the example which I gave you, these are the stuff which we build. Khojo project I gave you, these are the stuff which we build it. Not all the stuff. Okay. Right?
Central theme is like you have a independence in app development.
Hold on. Wait for, like I'll walk on. So I have not spoke what we do. So I'll walk you through what Aegis actually does. Right?
But what so, you show something internalized by you on
yes, the right versions. Yes. These are our products, right? So I have no right to really come and blabber you if we ourselves have not done something, right? And showing some random videos of others. So I'll spend another few minutes to talk about what Aegis is. Aegis was started in 2002 with Bharti Airtel support. We are one of the rare institutions which started with industry and academia collaboration, right? So we started with telecommunication management program. And then 2015, we married to IBM, and this marriage was successful. Our babies are healthy, earning money and earning name for themselves, working almost in every company. we are one of the institutions which can claim that we have a zero-day campus. 2 months back, we had a zero-day campus. Three days, 27 companies came. Average was 14.5, highest was 22 lakh, minimum was 8.5. The highest for experience even went to 40 lakh rupees, right? So this is what our credentials are. We have collaboration with these four companies. No institution in India can really claim that. IBM is our partner, AWS is our partner, NVIDIA is our partner, and Ubitech. Ubitech is a robotics company based in China, $5 billion valuation. We were recognized by IBM for our contribution in building up skills in analytics and data science. This is the program we launched. We were the first one to start a data science program in India. So we started postgraduate program in data science, business analytics, and big data when nobody knew about data science. And this I'm not talking about 50 years back. This I'm talking about right in 2015. We have the largest alumni working in industry, which is roughly around 600. Nobody can really claim that in full time they have the 600 alumni. Right? Online is a different ball game. 95%, by the way, those who join our program, they've already completed online courses. Online courses, you can study, you can talk, you can do bullshit, but you can't really build the real application. These are only for those who are working already in this area. So you've done machine learning, perhaps you can really do TensorFlow online. You can really learn, but learning deep machine learning yourself is extremely difficult. You can do, provided you have ruthless focus and you're very self-disciplined. That we have seen is rarely found. This is the joint certification you get from IBM. This PGP and data science, cybersecurity, which we started, I spoke about. This covers 360 degree aspect of all the areas. Application security, database security, ethical hacking, pen testing, digital forensic, IBM tool QRadar, deep learning, machine learning, cryptography, and even the mathematics. So all is being covered into this. First batch came out in Bangalore 3 months back, 0 day, half a batch was picked up by PwC. Right? No such program exists in entire Asia, entire Europe. Right? Most of the programs, unfortunately, in India, cybersecurity means ethical hacking. Right? So you download some dark tool from dark web and hack into some mobile phone. That's, I call them cyber magician. But those idiots even don't know the tool which they have downloaded is snooping the data from their laptop and mobile phone. Right? So there are two kind of people exist. Those who are idiot, those who download, and those who are super intelligent, but they don't do the hacking because they know that they will leave the digital trace and they will be caught. So they are on the defense side. So in cybersecurity, you may get motivated that those who are doing hacking, they are extremely intelligent. No. Unke baap baithe huye. And they never do that because they know they will get caught. Right? We are starting PGP in Applied AI in November. This program is designed for those who want to build applications, AI applications, right? So we'll talk about difference between AI and data science subsequently. PGP in full stack development, this we are starting in January. And this blockchain is for primarily for those who have full stack experience. This is not for freshers. Those who have worked in software development for 2 years, this is program for them. These are all 11 program available on weekend and full time, both mode. Now, these are the couple of statistics by different players, different agencies. What is the job scenario in India? let's move further. This is very important thing. 80% of the applications which you will be building will have the intelligence. That's the IDC. IDC reports are referred by all the CEOs and CTOs for making the future roadmap. You don't have to really wait. All the software which you are building, they are smart software. YouTube is a smart software. It's not a dumb rule-based software anymore. So every software engineer need to really run machine learning and NLP to really make better softwares. Okay, so a couple of projects which we are running. So we run Data Science Delivered, which is a part of Aegis as a consulting company. We take a lot of real life projects. We did churn prediction for Idea Vodafone. We did big data infrastructure, churn prediction for a company called Eon Infotech. We did some work for salespanda.com. So we do a lot of real work at our place. So what is AI? Dr. Gangopadhyay has explained you. There's nothing called AI. So the myth is there's nothing called AI. There's no singular technology called AI. AI is more of philosophy of bringing machines closer to the human being and transferring human intelligence and behaviors to the machine, right? And how we do that? By a couple of stack of technologies. One of the technologies called machine learning and deep learning, through which you train machines, you give a power to machine to learn. Like, for example, how do you really know that this is green and this is black? Because your mother taught you, right? And if you have to train machines to distinguish between cat and dog, you feed 100 images of cat, 100 images of dog, machine will learn, you show the next image, and machine will be able to really predict you with certain probability whether it is a cat or a dog. That's how human being learns, that's how the machine learns. And this capability you transfer through the machine learning and deep learning. All of you can really read? Yes, no. Now you want this capability to be transferred to the machines, like for example, reading reviews, doing the sentiment analysis, right? Like if Pappu post is doing well or what, how people are responding, you will do through the NLP. Natural language processing. You want machines to talk like a human being, speech to text, just like Alexa. These technologies built at IBM, and now they are part of the AI. Vision, just like a human vision capability. You want to give this capability to the machines. Just like this Khojo project. It's using computer vision. Right? So the moment it moves to the machines, it becomes computer vision. You want machines to dance like a human being. Right? This is called robotics. Now, current AI is like this. Current AI do not have two capabilities, which is touch sense and the smell sense. Now, I came across a research last week only. There is a researcher, Chinese researcher in Sweden. She did a research on building up a artificial skin. right? So hopefully in next 5 years, 6 years, you'll have a commercial touch sense as well. And in 10, 15 years, you'll have a smell sense, right? So you don't have to really go on Swiggy, you can actually smell. Arey, masala dosa ke smell achha aa raha hai, right? Garam hai. And then you order, right? And perhaps like it will stimulate your hormones and you will feel, you'll not feel hungry, right? So we'll reach to that error. Expert system, they take the decisions, right? But all these expert system also use all these capabilities. Expert system also have a lot of software component. So AI is basically subset of computer science, right? And AI is a stack of technology with the objective of making machines closer to the human being. That's all. But there is nothing singular AI. Machine learning, there are three ways you can define a machine learning. If you're a mathematician, you will say, okay, machine learning is nothing, but it's basically glorified form of statistics. Partly true, partly wrong. Computer science guys, okay, I don't have to really rewrite a program. The program learns at its own through the data. That's software engineer's definition. Data scientist, analyst definition is the method through which I can really find the pattern in the data, I can do the prediction. That's the three definitions, depending on who is using it. Fair enough? In next 5 minutes, you'll learn what questions machine learning can answer. Machine learning can answer you a couple of questions. It can do infinite things, but it can answer only few questions. One, kitna deti hai, right? How much rain Mumbai will have next year? What will be the stock price of Tech Mahindra, say, next Monday, right? What will be the India's population? How many vehicles Mumbai will be having? So these are the questions which is related to numeric. If you have the historical data, you can really predict about the future. This is called regression. Regression is there in statistics for last 200 years, recently borrowed in machine learning. And that's the reason the statisticians say that machine learning is nothing but a glorified form of statistics. Second, classification problem. So you want to classify whether it is dog or a cat or elephant, whether this has got a cancerous cell or a normal cell, do you have viral or a malaria, right? You have a broken bone or a normal bone. This is red or a black. So those kind of classification problems. You have tons of classification algorithms. The other kind of problem you can solve, how do I organize this data? So I give you 300 million customers data of Vodafone or Idea, Airtel, and I say, okay, reorganize this data. So you can use your prejudice or you can really let this machine do. So machine will organize based on the, say, high data usage or voice usage. Earlier, companies used to categorize, segment customers based on age or sex or location, those kind of stuff. Those models are failing. So segmentation is basically, it's a use in marketing and in computer science it is used as a clustering. This creates a cluster of groups of similar characteristics. Fair enough? Is it weird or a normal behavior? So just like a credit card example I gave you, right? The another stuff which is used in driverless cars and games, what is the next best action I should really do? And that's where reinforcement learning is used, right? in AlphaGo or in Deep Blue, these kind of stuff, or even driverless cars. Tools which are used are Python, SAS, MATLAB for a large scale of data, Apache Mammoth. And then SparkMLib. SparkMLib is something which we use. So we had a data of around 40 GB data for churn prediction. We did through SparkMLib. You can't really analyze and do machine learning on R if you have a large scale of data, right? entire Watson platform runs on the Spark. That's the data infrastructure layer on Watson. Then you will be using Microsoft Azure, ML over Azure, ML over AWS, ML over GCP, right? Why? Because not everybody is having that level of competency of building up a good software. You build up a model, take that code, use it, and this will generate an API which can be consumed into some app or a web, right? Also, this will really take care of the data infrastructure, which you don't have to really worry about that. Deep learning is a baby of machine learning, recently came into prominence post 2012, and this is primarily used for images, video and text kind of data. Accuracy level is high. The downside is these are black boxes. Understanding mathematics is difficult. Explainability is difficult. Couple of questions which you will be asking in business. What is happening? This is called exploration, right? The other question which you will ask in business, what happened? You release an advertisement for OnePlus, how many people bought? So you expected 5 million, people bought only 2 million. Why did it happen, right? What will happen? So if you did a prediction that you will sell only 2 million instead of a 5 million, what will happen? You will incur losses. So you visit a doctor, you have a fever, 104 degree because of malaria. If I don't treat you, when you will die, right? So I really write you prescription. So prediction is very prominent. But in big data area, all these questions become prominent, right? You open a Ola app, it gives you prediction, 5 minutes, you press the button, it prescribes you a car, right? That they have resolved the issue of optimization problem, which is a pretty long problem. And what did I learn? This is how the human being works. So you bypass all these steps. As a human being, we respond based on what we learn, right? We don't go through this process. So if I ask you, I borrowed your money 5 times, 6th time, will you give me the money or not? What is your answer? Huh? Wrong answer. Then why the hell you gave me even 5th time? If that was the case, you would have not given me the 3rd time or the 2nd time. You will give me 6th time if you have given me 5th time. Because that's a learned behavior. So perhaps we have very strong, deep friendship, and your mother's influence is much more, who is sentimental, than your CA father, right? Hypothetical scenario. So you respond based on the how you have learned, right? If her father is CA and she has a huge influence of her father, she'll not even give me 1st time based on my credit history, right? Fair enough? Okay. Data scientist, you read this article or read only this advertisement? This title is used as a good advertisement, but this is an amazing article. This is written by DJ Patil. You should really go and read this article. He wrote this article in 2012. I know most of the data scientists in this country and most of the known data scientists around the world. Neither they are sexy nor their job is sexy. This is like a messy job, absolutely messy job. The only sexiness is money, and that's the reason you guys are on Sunday afternoon rather than watching movie and roaming around in the malls, right? Fair enough. What kind of money they get? Obscene money, which I told you. Like in first batch only, a guy, fresh guy, who's non-engineers. By the way, non-engineers are non-human in this country, right? He got 13 lakh, right? And that gave a shock wave to all the engineers. That how this happened, right? He's non-engineer. He got 13 lakh, double the package than I got, right? So this is the scenario. So myth number two, everybody can become data scientist. Because even dog is data scientist, because while he's crossing the road, he analyzes the data. And all of us, we really do, right? data scientists, they are magicians. They can work under the extreme uncertainties. One of my students joined a bank. His boss told him, okay, gentlemen, here is the deal. Here is the data, analyze the data, come to me in 1 week's time with some right questions. I'm not telling you what need to be done. You do it or else find another job. He did it, retained his job. So, unlike other professions where the boss tells you ki ye problem solve karna hai, data science mein nahi, right? You will be given a data and then you analyze, because as a businessman, I'll tell you the biggest problem is identifying the right question. If you can formulate the question, you will find the answer, right? Of course, there is a process, it is also difficult, but the most difficult thing is to identify the right question. Data science is all about making the sense out of the data. Only problematic stuff is data. Now, pre-2000, when we didn't have the data, much data, we were analyzing the structured data. So the only the picture comes to our head whenever we talk about data is Excel sheet data. Ye naam hai, age hai, sex hai, income hai, address hai, this is the, like a data comes to our head. That's a artificial structured data. The real data is a messy data. When we are talking, this is unstructured data. There's no pattern in that. Right? It includes voice, log file, text, emailers, and words. 90% of the data is unstructured data, specifically in legal domain, it's specifically in healthcare. It's unstructured data, right? Massive amount of the unstructured data. But we realize the power of data once these internet companies, which laid down their foundation in mid-90s and late 90s, they started seeing the traction in post-2000. And that's how the big data revolution started coming in. And big data platform was invented by a gentleman called Doug Cutting. He invented Hadoop, right? Hadoop, what it does, it offers the flexibility. There's no dependency on server means commodity hardware, you can establish Hadoop. It has got flexibility, means you can store any kind of data, be it image, be it video, be it log file, structured, unstructured. Speed is faster. Fourth, most important, there is no licensing fees because it was donated to Apache Foundation. This happened in 2008, right? And 2008, this data scientist word was coined by DJ Patil and his friend Jeff, who used to work in Facebook, and DJ Patil was working in LinkedIn. Both of these guys was pretty frustrated with this designation of data analyst, but they were doing much advanced level of job of the analytics, right? Data analytics and business analytics. Because data analysts, business analysts, they were traditionally analyzing the structured data, only row column data and small data. But DJ Patil and Jeff were building up a lot of recommender system, doing a lot of text analytics and other stuff, which were not part of data analytics domain. And that's the reason data scientist word came. So a lot of people say data science is a subset of analytics. I would bluntly say they're idiot, they don't understand. Because the monkeys, humans came after monkeys, not monkeys came after a human being. Right? If there was no need of data scientists and analysts were doing the good job, there was no need of data scientists to come in the first place. Right? India, this whole wave started post this article. And when Paytm offered $350K to 8 data scientists, but none of them was hired, they were all were hired in Toronto. So this is one characteristic. Data over here is a large data and the data coming from multiple sources, right? And that's where the data scientists play a role. The other thing is good definition about data science is analytics plus AI, traditional analytics plus AI. Now, to analyze the structured data, mathematics is sufficient. But if you have to analyze the text, which technique you will use? Natural language processing, I told you, right? NLP is a part of AI, and AI is part of computer science. If you have to train machines to find the pattern and learn at its own, what technique you'll use? What technique you'll use? Guys, come on. Don't give me a feel of that I am Asharam Bapu on post-lunch. Machine learning and deep learning, right? This is AI technique. If you want, and then you will be analyzing the big data. So big data is also there, right? So you are borrowing a lot of AI techniques, which is machine learning, which is natural language processing, which is computer vision for image analysis, and big data for a large data. Fair enough? So modern data science is basically traditional analytics plus AI. So there's no difference between AI and data science. This is a useless question. Why I'm telling you? Because I have seen a lot of hundreds of idiots answering, those who are millions of guys asking question, what is the difference between data science and AI? Right? In real time, data scientists can do analysis and they can build data products. Right? But AI guys, they don't do analysis, they simply build products. That's the only difference. But data scientists, they are better AI guys because they have a deeper understanding about mathematics. And because mathematics is basically engine for learning not only machine, but mathematics is the only language through which you can understand how the world is functions. Right? Not Hindi, not Marathi, not Sanskrit. Data science is about automating the data science. Right? So data scientists can build data products. And that's where they cross the line with AI guys. So most of the data scientists designate JDs and AI JDs, you'll find there are a lot of commonalities. Lot of ML JDs are basically data science JDs. Clear? But anyway, by the way, you don't have to really get into this debate. If I have hired you to solve a problem. I have hired you to build some systems and I hired you to give me the advice. I have not hired to come and debate me ki sir ye to computer vision ka problem hai, ye to AI ka problem. Sir, maine to analytics sikha tha, marketing analytics sikha tha IIMs mein. Meko computer vision to pata nahi. Then get lost. Why you are over here, right? You are here to solve a problem and that's the reason you are being paid. Clear? So people will not really get into this debate. And first of all, they will not really hire you. Where it is applied, not a single industry which we have seen which does not use, including the government. Right? You need to have the domain knowledge. You don't have to really worry about the domain knowledge because you will work with domain experts. Right? And subsequently, you will learn. Those who have domain knowledge, they have the added advantage. Like, for example, you have a telecom experience, right? So you can easily formulate the problem. Then math. Math is the engine, right? And then machine learning and tons of IT tools, which keeps on changing. R, Python, Hadoop, Scala, Tableau, ClickSense, Cognos, IBM Watson, and all those stuff. They come and they go. These two things will not change. They have not changed. Right? This is a good representation, crude representation of this is data analyst, this is business analyst, this is data scientist. Their job is same. The only thing they can really do at much better scale, and they can do a much better job than other guys. This is wrong to say that business analysts, they have a better understanding about business, because business analysts were working in industry for last 20, 30 years. So definitely they're bound to have a better business insight than the data analyst. But data scientists need to understand the business. A lot of mid-sized companies, startup companies stopped hiring business analysts. They're hiring only data scientists. I wrote a blog which says that data scientists are going to replace the business analysts. Right? Like Shadi.com, do not hire business analysts. So don't get into this wrong impression that as a data scientist, your job is only to really build machine learning algorithm that even an idiot and even 12th fail boy can really do. Company like Data Robots are going to really replace you. They can really apply a better machine learning algorithm than the human being, right? So you need to understand the business anyhow. But for that, you don't have to really learn the MBA. I have not seen any company which is coming and telling, Bhupesh, we need student, those who know marketing analytics or say financial analytics or operations analytics, because that these are the applications. Anyway, you can really take elective. What you need to really concentrate, understanding this broader spectrum of technologies, and get deeper into the mathematics. Okay, how do you enter into this field? Read this blog. There are tons of other blogs are there. Download these white papers. You can Google it. You can download our white paper published along with Deloitte and Aegis. Data science, right? How it is transforming ICT. You can take a snapshot. And the other blog is, white paper is about big data in telecom. These two white papers will clarify your concepts about data science and big data. How do I enter into this field? There are a lot of free courses out there. You can pick up. You can join PGP in data science at Aegis. And there's other good institution, IIT Kharagpur, IIM Kolkata, ISI. Right? They offer, these three institutions offer this program. So these are the only two good institutions I can really recommend. Those who are planning overseas, they can think about University of Berkeley. They have MS in data science. New York University, they have MS in data science. Some advice. Look at the curriculum and look at the faculty, right? Which is very critical. Don't go to a business school, because business school professors don't understand machine learning and NLP. They only understand business, and that's what they are capable of teaching, right? Instead of that, you do the business MBA, your prospect will be better. But you don't go, because this is typically you have to go for MS in data science, not PGDBM or MBA in data science, right? Because MBA in data science cannot exist. Because AICT, UGC dictates a term that 80% of the curriculum has to be management. And 20% you will study R or SAS, which will not make you even salesman. Right? Next, if your father is still having the black money after demonetization, you don't have a gray cell, you want to do suicide, go and join MBA in data science or MBA in business analytics. Right? And I have given enough dose about that. Those who know R, Python, Hadoop, any of these skills, you can apply as an intern. You can become research scholar to us. We'll suck your blood and we'll make you man. And you can really work on real life project. And we'll pay you as well. But very small money, right? Fair enough. Any questions, guys? Okay, good. So thank you so much for your patient hearing. I'm tired. Any question? Okay, good. Thank you so much. Sorry. Yeah.
Regarding the cyber security one, So how deep we are getting into the machine learning and deep learning techniques?
Quite deep.
In the cyber security.
Quite deep.
So is the basic understanding of the cyber security also will be there, or?
Yes, that's what I told you. You can't do cyber security if you don't understand the domain. So you need to understand the network. You need to have the network security understanding, basic network, cryptography, application security, database security, cloud security, because you will be analyzing these areas. And then on top of that, machine learning with Python and deep learning.
Okay. So actually, I'm looking for this cyber security program, but good. I'm already data scientist, but I don't have wonderful. A domain knowledge on the cyber security.
So you should opt for that course. It's a wonderful course. Sandesh will really talk about how you can fill up the application and other stuff. Right? Okay. But no, that's a brilliant course. When we really design the course, we put our soul. We don't do the copy paste.
Does the program give the basics of all the...
Yes, basics of everything. Okay. We build from the scratch.
Okay.
Even in data science, we hold your hand right from linear algebra, okay. probability, right? So we don't presume. If I ask you how many of you know linear equation, 90% will not be able to really answer. Okay. Right? We know that your teachers have not taught us, right? Yeah, please, sir.
So somebody who has hated science, stats, maths, uniformly throughout his life,
right.
was never anywhere near engineering or programming,
right.
has been into HR for donkey's years,
right.
how do you relate with such a profile as a data scientist? Or should I stay on my domain and do something which can be customized?
Okay, so it is heavily used in HR. So today you can't really recruit a person just without using analytics, right? Those,
but
how long?
Independent consultant, I'm 53 now. If I'm going to drop out of a national organization going forward.
You're just 6 years older to me.
Yeah, no.
So I'll tell you. So I had.
To make this topic public is, does your curriculum have something for people like us who have aptitude wise certain limits?
So I understood your question. So let us come on age. When we designed this course, we designed this course typically for those who are below 35. In reality, we got roughly around 20% students, those were older than me, right? So we had one guy, Suhash Aldir, he's 58. He was just retiring on the Hexaware. He is IIT Kharagpur product. Every Saturday, Sunday, sports shoes used to come, and then post-retirement, he became a consultant, right? We had IIT Bombay gold medalist guy. He was 55. He joined this course. Now, these guys, why they joined this program? Because they spent their entire life in technology. And they realize that they will not die before 75. What are they going to really do? So a lot of people not coming only to really get the next job, but be relevant. The outcome was that they could really get a lot of consulting assignment, and it increased their longevity. One. Those who joined post 35, of course, they have a huge fear that they will lose the job and they will not really grow. Those who at early age, like say 22 to 30, they wanted a better job, or they were not happy with the current income, right? So people come with different aspirations and different expectations. Coming back, you hated mathematics, nobody hates mathematics, right? You run your home, you will not spend more money than which is in your pocket. So naturally, we all believe in mathematics. We hated mathematics because the person who taught us, they never explained us why we were studying in mathematics. We can all think mathematically. And not only human being, even a dog can think mathematically. वो जब road cross करता है ना, वो नहीं cross करता जब 120 की speed पे car आ रही है, क्योंकि उसको पता है वो मर जाएगा. वो calculate करता है. Your brain is designed to think mathematically. So first of all, don't say that you hate mathematics. Lot of people hate coding because this is the way they were taught. But our human brains actually programs. It works in a very rational fashion. Rationality is a logic. Coding is a logic, is a sequence of a logic. It's a only who has taught you. And whether they have told you why you're doing that. Why I have shown you a couple of movie clips. Because I wanted to invoke your interest. I want to really see, tell you from where it is coming rather than just telling you there are enough jobs, which everybody is telling you. So it depends who teaches you, how teaches you. Most of us, our interest was killed, right? When you really see that, yes, you can really do a better prediction about whom you want to really hire, whom you want to really give increment just based on, not based on your gut feel or based on our relation. Because as a human being, we are biased. Biases comes based on our limited data availability. For example, he is good friend, either I will underestimate him, or if he is distant from me, I may hate him. But when we come closer, we get a lot of data and we neutralize our expectations. That's how human being works, right? Can you really stop someone before he will put up the resignation? If you're working in an organization about 10,000, yes, data science can really give those insights. Because you have that data in your SAP system, that data is your computer is generating, that data is coming in the feedback form, but we are not able to collect that data which is coming from the multiple form and connect dots and some find that insight. I am not saying perfect systems are available today, but lot of work being done. Today we can really do the, if you give me the data, we can really actually give you the prediction model that who is likely to really leave, or will tell you what kind of data you need to start collecting. It's important. So even in your field, it is heavily used. It's a heavily used. You go and search for people analytics conference. So look, let's understand. There are two aspects. Depending on, say, the two ways. One is why I need to really know how the printer works. I can buy a printer and let the printer does this job. Okay? That low level of stuff is not going to really work in this area because this is too complicated. An example is also wrong. So if you want to be a leader, you need to really go something deeper. On 10 scale, perhaps on 4 or 5. You can't really just say that, okay, I know AI, AI is artificial intelligence. 99% leaders don't know beyond artificial intelligence. You need to have some deeper level of understanding. I'm not saying that you can have the ability to write algorithms, but you'll not appreciate someone who's doing the job, and you will give him some task which will be unrealistic task, and your team will be frustrated. Because these leaders, they attend multiple conferences, and these conferences give them unexpected, unrealistic expectation. And they think, okay, I have hired data scientists, I'm paying you 50 lakh rupees, okay, increase my revenue by 20%. Damn it. If I can increase your revenue by 25%, then I will become a chairman. So let us talk sense, right? Since you attended some conference, you have no understanding, and then you will humiliate me. Oh, you're data scientist. Much qualified than me, getting more salary than me, do transformation. Now, this will not really work. So you have to have some level of understanding so that you can assemble a team. So if you know a couple of use cases, so it depends on you how you want to really see yourself. Okay. Right? So generally for leaders, we recommend that you at least know use cases, know deeper little bit, right? Even those who are older guys, those who join our program, we force them to actually do the coding. We say, whether you do coding in your real life or not, but you need to get away with the phobia of coding, that coding is something launching a rocket in NASA. No, it is not. It is very logical fashion, and that will really help you to think logically in your workplace. These are certain outcomes, and you will be more empathetic towards your team. That yes, they are doing this job, just rather than saying that they are nerds. No, they are not nerds. You have to groom those nerds to become the next business leader. Right? That's what my personal take. Because I run a business, what is the need of for me to really learn that? I have faculties who can really talk. Today, if I really don't understand, I'm a telco guy. But last 5 years, I have learned every bit about AI and data science. I'm not saying that I am an expert. But today, at least I can really judge which faculty need to hire and which faculty not. Right?
I'll use the word forced to use change technology thrice just to survive in my job, quote unquote. Okay, now a fourth time is coming, so I was just seeking an opportunity or maybe some advice from you guys. Does it give me an independent and freelancing opportunity?
Yes, yes, certainly.
It's just like I continue to do an
AGIS, yes, certainly.
And flaunt an AGIS paper, which means nothing inside my job.
So, you humans anyway are going to become redundant in the next 100 years. So today,
I am today also.
Yeah. So today, you have to acquire higher level of skills to really understand what is happening around the world. Forget about contributing. I am saying to understand what is happening. First, you have to really reach to that level ki cricket mein kya chal raha ho to samjhe. Fir uske baad khelne ke liye andar jayenge. To agar samajh mein aa raha hai game, to chalo commentary to kar lenge agar khel nahi paaye to.
You can suggest something which can help
yes.
In my HR current.
So start with People Analytics Conference. We did People Analytics Conference in June. There are a lot of couple videos over there. Just go through it. That will really further help you. Okay. Right? Okay? And I'm sure this must have helped you to really gain some basic understanding beyond the artificial intelligence. Okay? So I invite Sandesh. He'll give you spend some 10-15 minutes. He'll give you some idea about course, how you can really join those who are interested. Thank you guys, thank you so much.
PPT going on. Full screen. Full screen, kaise? Check. So hi guys, we have been here for almost 3 hours now. So a lot of data has, you know, you have been exposed to a lot of data and you have also assimilated it. So my name is Sandesh, I'm part of the admissions team with Aegis, okay? So Bhupesh sir has given you all a brief idea about what Aegis does, how we offer the programs. So I'll not take much of your time, right? The agenda is I'll quickly run you through what we have to offer in terms of programs, right? Okay, and how it can benefit you and maybe which is the right program for you. Because based upon your individual requirement, every program will not be suitable. There will be certain programs which are the best suited for you, all right? So the three major programs which we offer are PGP in data science, business analytics, big data, PGP in applied AI, machine learning, deep learning, and PGP in cybersecurity. Now all these three programs are co-certified by IBM, okay? So IBM is our academic partner, okay? The final certification which you get is through IBM. Second thing which is important is all these three courses are MS equivalent. Now what do I mean when I say it is MS equivalent? It is not a master's degree, okay? But when I say it is MS equivalent, what it means is all these programs come with an equivalent credit structure. I'm sure everyone must have heard about the credit structure system, right? So we follow a North American credit structure. So all of these programs come with the requisite credits, wherein they are recognized globally as master's degree, okay? So these are the sample certificates. Like already the IBM one was shown by Bhupesh sir, right? And we also have one more certification which we give, which is with NVIDIA, just for the deep learning part. So NVIDIA is the leading provider for GPU, graphical processing units. Now coming to the core curriculum or the courses which we offer, we call them the core courses. Now like you already are aware that you know, we do a lot of research in developing the courses which we have, right? So how it works is we work with the industry, because IBM, NVIDIA and other partners are there, which are the industry partners. We get constant feedback from them that what is relevant in the industry, right? So like Bhupesh sir already explained to you that Python is now, for example, the in thing, whereas R is maybe not so much. So we constantly keep revising our syllabus. This is just a snapshot of some of the courses which we cover, right? This include the robotics, computer vision, machine learning, Python. Also, we have a huge array of elective courses. So you can really build your own syllabus, right? About based on the topics which you want to learn. These are some of the examples of them. So as you can see, it's like a very wide range of products, right? Now coming to the question which I'm sure everyone has in the back of their mind is regarding the placements. So we offer a very comprehensive placement to all our students. This is some of the placement snapshots which we have. Now placements is done for everyone, irrespective of they are a fresher or they are a working professional. When I talk about numbers, the average placement for a fresher guy after completing our PGP course is around 8.5 lakhs per annum, right? This is the average. The lowest has been around 6.5 lakhs and it has gone up to 13 lakhs for freshers. In case of working professionals, we have had CTCs in the range of 40 lakhs as well. And in terms of hikes, we have had almost 300% to 400% hikes as well. These are some of our recruiting partners. You can have a look at them. So we follow a company on placement kind of. Companies come on the campus for placement model, where the companies come over here and the placement process is conducted. So typically we have the day zero concept, where the best companies with the best offers come and they pick up the students. In the recently concluded placement drive, we had almost close to 30 companies coming on campus on day zero. Now coming to some specifics in terms of testimonials, because I'm sure the crowd which we have, all of you come from very diverse backgrounds. So there might be some questions, like one gentleman had, that he has a lot of experience. So will this course be helpful for him in terms of career opportunities, etc.? There might be some question that I'm a non-engineer, so will I get a placement kind of thing? Okay, so we'll just go through some specific cases. Pointer kaise hai isme? Beech wala. Okay, so some cases I want to highlight is, one is Puneet Rathod. Okay, so this guy was a project manager in the IT industry before joining the course, and post course he is now working with as a director with Morgan Stanley, right? He got a salary hike of 175%. Another one I want to highlight is Pritesh Tiwari, right? He is currently working as an AI lead. So this guy, he was working earlier as a MIS executive, and the salary hike which he got was more than 400%. One more interesting one is, especially for the non-engineers, is Abhishek Gupta. So Abhishek Gupta was a fresher when he joined us, and he was a commerce graduate, he's a BCom, right? Post course completion, he's now working as a data scientist with PharmEasy. So it is a completely a myth, you know, that you need to be from a technical background or you need to be an engineer to get a good placement. As you can see, even BCom guys with no experience can also become and do become good data scientists as well, right? One more fresher person, okay, but this is an engineering fresher, Vigneshwar. He was also being a fresher. He is now working with Ernst & Young as a data scientist. We also have certain some students who have, you know, successfully shifted their domains from you know, being a person just without any background of a specific industry and going into very you know, industries which are perceived to have a requirement of a lot of experience, like Siddharth Prabhu. So he is now working with DHL as a project manager in the logistics industry. Now coming to specific cases of people, you know, with a lot of work ex. So we had some questions that I already have some lot of work ex, then will this course be useful for me? So these are a couple of cases. Raj Dhyani had around 27 years of work experience, and he was able to get a successful transition as a director of data science. Similarly, Suhas Hulalkar also had more than 30 to 33 years of experience. So even he was able to get a successful transition into the analytics domain. These are some snapshots of the learning management system which we have, which is the IIM University. It's a very robust and very easy to use LMS, which you can access even from your mobile phone. So you need not have to continuously log into your laptop or computer. This is accessible through your mobile phone as well. These are again some snapshots of the same. It also runs videos and all, which you can access on the go as well. Now coming to the program, we basically have three delivery models. Okay, one is a full-time classroom kind of course, which runs Monday to Friday, where you need to devote your entire day. So that's basically like a college kind of model, right? This is mandatory for a person who doesn't have any work experience. So if you do not have any work experience and you do want to pursue this course, then you will need to opt for the full-time program. Alternatively, we also have people who quit their jobs, okay, and focus full-time on this. So that is again purely a personal decision on your basis, so how much commitment you want to put in, right? Next model is, sorry, the other model which we have is executive weekend on campus, okay? So this is the program which runs Saturday, Sunday, okay? The content remains the same. Now this would be ideal for a person who want to continue with their job but also want to learn, right? The content remains the same, the certification which you receive at the end of the program also remains the same, and the placement opportunities you get also remain the same. The thing to realize over here, or the important thing over here, is that we need people to have good time management skills, and that inherently comes with working professional. So as a rule, a person without work experience of at least 1 to 2 years, preferably 2 years or 1 year of hardcore relevant experience, can do this program. People without work experience cannot do this program. Okay? And the final mode is the online executive model. Now, there are a lot of online courses which are there, right? How this one is, how our program is different is, these are live sessions. So the sessions are broadcasted live on Saturday, Sundays, right? So as learners, you have the access to ask your doubts, right? And they get cleared instantly. So typically what happens in a learning platform, where the, you know, the downfall is that you have access to all the content, but the motivation to complete the same is not always there, because honestly, like, you also know that if something is just given to you, right, without any interaction, the completion rate generally drops. So hence we have decided to give a live interactive format to the online one. We also have the sessions recorded. So in the case if you miss any sessions, you can definitely access the recorded ones also. Admission process, in case you want to go for the any of our programs, is pretty straightforward. You have to fill an online application, which will be followed by a personal or Skype interview. And if selected, an admission offer will be released to you. Questions? Mike, please. Mike. Yeah.
When you go for this program, what about the hardware? Is it going to, Aegis is going to provide all the platforms?
So all the tools which you get, all the technologies which are there, will be accessible to you through the cloud.
Cloud.
That will be through us. Yeah. Mike, there.
What's the course timing during weekdays and weekends?
So weekdays, it's just like a college kind of model. So it's from morning 10 to evening 5 to 6. And on weekends, Saturday, Sunday, the timing is there, 10 to 6, 10 to 7.
But then, like, you have 5-day program, like weekdays is a 5-day program and on weekends.
So how come we'll complete the both in 11 months, basically? Yeah. So like I said, in the weekend one, we emphasize that the person should be working professional simply because he has that time management skill. So he needs to cover the entire content, okay, in the same duration, but he needs to do most of it, you know, some of it rather on his own. Because on the weekdays, part, the faculties are available for handholding. In the weekends, ones, he needs to manage that time on his own.
Okay. But still, the question is, like, you covering the course module, like if you have 5 days in a week and you are taking like 6 hours a day, so it's like 30 hours every week.
Yeah.
And then
so
again,
In the weekday one, we have a lot more handholding. Okay. As compared to the weekend one. So the faculties are available throughout the day. The students are there on campus much more. In the weekend one, that is not possible because the student is working, right? So major component is covered on the weekends. For the certain specific part, the student has to, you know, manage his time and cover on his own.
Okay.
Yeah. Question? You had a question, right? No? Okay.
This is the format. So course duration will be 6 months or 1 year?
11 months.
11.
Yeah.
In all formats,
yeah. So we have batches which are commencing for all the programs, all right? So like for machine learning, and we are starting with the full-time batch in November end. And for all the formats, we are starting with the weekend and the online one from 1st of December. So typically, like I said, the application admission process starts with filling up the online application. The cost for online application is 500 rupees. But if you fill it right now, we are offering it for 100 rupees. So if any one of you is interested to fill the application form, they can do it right now.
And then costs of the course?
It depends on the different this thing. Which one are you interested in more? AI and ML PGP, if you're going for the weekend one or the online one, it is 2.5 lakhs all inclusive. So based on the exact course and the mode of delivery, it slightly varies.
So,
yeah.
I've just started working.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have 1 year of experience. So mm-hmm. can I join for weekend course?
Where are you working right now?
L&T.
Okay. And what is your graduation?
Oh, I did my master in statistics.
Okay. So since yours is a profile which is, you know, into statistic and maths, so we may make an exception. I will not commit to you that we will allow you. What I suggest, you fill the application form.
Okay.
So we'll conduct a couple of interviews with you, one on a technical
okay.
basis and one on a generalist basis.
Okay.
So based on the evaluation, then we'll be able to let you know.
Okay.
Because since you have that background of being into statistics, we may be able to accommodate it. Okay, any other questions? All right, thank you.